welcome and good evening to the City of Shakopee City Council meeting for December 6, 2016. If we could please now call the roll.
Yes, Mr. Mayor. Councilmember Luce.
Here.
Councilmember Lehman.
Here.
Mayor Mars.
Here.
Councilmember Whiting.
Here.
Councilmember Mokel is absent tonight.
Thank you very much. Let's all stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Item number three, approval of the agendas. Any additions, deletions, subtractions?
None that staff is aware of, Mr. Mayor.
Councilor Luce?
E1 and E2.
Adding or taking off?
Taking off.
Well, we're not to the consent agenda yet.
I'll make a motion to approve the agenda as presented.
I have a second by Councilor Lehman to approve the agenda as stated. Discussion. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? Motion carries. Thank you. Now, moving ahead to consent business. Any additions? Deletions? Councilor Luce?
E1, E2.
4E1, 4E2. Others? Councilor Whiting?
I'll make a motion to approve the consent agenda as amended.
Councilor Lehman?
4D1 will be removed, and I'll second the motion.
4 what?
4D1 is removed from consent, and I will second the motion.
And I have a second and an add 4D1. And others? Seeing none, before we vote, we will have a reading of the modified consent agenda. Mr. Reynolds.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. This is the consent agenda items for December 6 of 2016. 4B1 declares bikes and miscellaneous items held by the police department as surplus property and authorizes their proper sale or disposal. 4B2 adopts resolution number 7806, which approves a grant agreement with the Minnesota Department of Public Safety for the Southwest Metro Drug Task Force. 4B3 approves the joint powers agreement for the Southwest Metro Drug Task Force. 4B4 declares 5 forfeited vehicles held by the police department as surplus property and authorizes their proper sale or disposal. 4B5 authorizes appropriate city staff to enter into an agreement to extend the school resource officer agreement with Shakopee Independent School District number 720 for the 2017 calendar year. 4C1 approves receipt of the Shakopee East End Sanitary Sewer Study and adopts resolution number 7804, which orders an improvement and preparation of plans and specifications for a sanitary sewer extension design from CSAH-16 to Whispering Oaks Lift Station. 4C2 approves receipt of the Shakopee West End Sanitary Sewer Study. 4C3 adopts resolution number 7803, which accepts work on the 2016 Street Reconstruction Project 2016 TAC 1. 4C4 authorizes the purchase of 4 SUV police interceptors from Nelson Auto Center in the amount of $118,843.80 to be paid from the Capital Equipment Internal Service Fund. 4C5 authorizes the use of the repurchase agreement with Ziegler Incorporated for 1 new CAT 287DW track skid steer loader in the amount of $6,800 to be paid from the Surface Water Fund, and authorizes the use of the repurchase agreement with Lano Equipment Incorporated for 3 new Bobcat S570 skid steer loaders in the amount of $11,685.90 to be paid from the Capital Equipment Internal Service Fund. 4F1 approves the payment of bills and electronic transfers in the amount of $5,374,424.71. 4F2 approves the minutes of the September 20th and October 4th, 2016 meetings. 4F3 approves the recommended 9 SAC credits valued at $4,275 in City of Shakopee credits and $22,365 in Metropolitan Council Sewer Availability Charge credits to Liberty Properties, LLC. And 4F4 approves the application and grants an on-sale 3.2% malt liquor license to Sonora, LLC, 815 First Avenue West.
Mr. Reynolds, thank you very much. the consent agenda. We have a motion and a second on the table. It has been read. There would be no further discussion on consent. Did you have a question, Mr. or Councilor?
No, I was going to point out the savings on the street reconstruction. Nearly $100,000, which was a good thing. And one other thing that I wanted to make a comment on was that, clearly this up with Mr. Nelson this week, that we are the only person that take, or city entity that takes care of the Southwest Metro Drug Task Force finances. So, but that was, there was a question on that in a different meeting.
Great, thank you. For the motion to approve the modified consent, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, motion carries unanimously. Thank you very much. Moving ahead then to item number five, now I'd like to ask any citizen that would like to come forward on an item not on the agenda, please come forward, state your name and address for the record on an item not on the agenda. Yes. Yeah.
My name is Joanne Newgard, and
welcome.
Hi. I'm coming to the City Council to seek approval of a special event permit or application. I am interested in starting the Shakopee River Valley Festival. The festival would be September 16th and 17th. The 16th would be in Huber Park with a couple bands, some kids games, some food trucks, and I'm not sure about a liquor vendor yet because I have not been able to find a nonprofit who is interested. On the 17th would be a parade on 10th from Lions Park to the Shakopee West Junior High. So I just kind of wondering if I'm trying to seek approval.
And Mr. Reynolds?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just to be clear, there's nothing actually in front of council at this point. I believe Ms. Newgard is just trying to give council a heads up of what the plans are in the future for this particular event. That will be coming in the future at some point.
Councilor Whitey?
I'm sorry, I missed the month you were planning.
It's September 16th
September.
And 17th. The reason I'm coming so early in front of the council is I need to get the IRS documents in order to become a 501c3 nonprofit. And the application needs dates, which events, times, and locations. So in order to do that, I have to come and ask a little bit early. The 501c3 takes about 4 months to come back with a letter of determination, 4 to 5 months. one other thing I do want to ask is, if it is approved, I am wondering if Matt Lehman can be acting liaison for the new festival to help guide everything the right way.
Let's start down here. The city clerk want to make a comment on this?
Yes, Mayor and Council. I have received the special event license permit application. We're working with the other departments to make sure that everything's in place before we approve it, make sure that all fees or whatever is necessary. We can have that by the next meeting. That shouldn't be difficult to get her the approval so that she can go ahead with her 501c3, but we can bring it to council at the next meeting.
Council Member Lehman, thank you.
Mayor, if let's see if I get this right. So September 16th, you're doing a function in the park, correct. Huber Park.
Correct, Huber Park.
And the 17th is a parade on 10th Avenue.
Correct.
So I mean, if everything's in place prior to the event and there's no, you know, issues from the city standpoint, I would be in favor of your festival. Granted, there's a process that it has to work its way. So I have no problem with that. But, you know, you're going to need approvals for closing the street and these types of things. We've done it in the past for Derby Days, so it's not anything out of the ordinary. Matter of fact, my understanding is it's much smaller than in the past, so it should be much easier to manage, which is probably a good thing to start out. Derby Days, I read it online from the Shakopee Valley News that they're dissolving, so I don't have that liaisonship as of they're dissolving. Mm-hmm. So I'd absolutely like to take what I've learned from them in their processes and help you. And I know what the city is looking for, working with Derby Days for the many years. I think it's a great opportunity to utilize what I've learned.
Yeah, and we do, I just want to clarify, we do understand that we have to pay for, you know, the items to make this festival run smoothly. So that's the other reason that I have to get that 1023 application into the IRS so that I can fundraise appropriately and be very crystal clear to individuals and businesses in town that it is a 501c3. The other thing is the committee is made up of me as president, Roger Menden, who he takes care of all the financials. I don't have any, none of us have access to credit cards, checks, any kind of financials. And then we have a secretary, Shoshana Anderson. So I just want to let you know that, you know, everything is very clear as far as Mr. Menden handling the finances. So there wouldn't be an issue that I can see with financials. I would be fundraising, and I fundraised for Derby Days off and on for about 8 years. And I think Matt Lehman and Jay will attest to I'm able to fundraise. So I wanted to clarify that, just so people understand that everything behind that.
Councilor Whiting?
I've been involved with Derby Days in the past many, many years. There's a process, and I think you talked about the city clerk, and I think the Parks Department will need some sort of process and forms, and I'm sure you're aware of all of that.
Right.
Unfortunately, without anything in front of us tonight, we can't really do any kind of action on it.
Right, right.
So, but yeah, appreciate the work you're putting into it and look
sure.
forward.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
So I wanted to thank you for the opportunity to start a new group for a new festival for our community. I think it's important. Commend you for that. Your permit process is in the process, and if as of now, it sounds like it'll be in front of us in 2 weeks.
Okay.
For any action, and that going to be enough time for you?
Sure, that'll be fine. Yeah. So I apologize for not understanding the whole process. So do I just come back to the next council meeting?
That would be great, in 2 weeks.
Okay.
Or contact staff and make sure everything's in order with your application. And
okay.
Yeah.
Sure. Okay. Thank you.
Did you have a comment, Councilor?
I'm supportive of it too. Yeah. More power to you. I hope you wish you the best.
Sure. And one more thing, I just want to let you know, any kind of paperwork having to do with the festival, I don't know if you need a copy of that. I mean, I would be happy to provide a copy of everything to the city so that you know what's all involved in
submit
the 1023 application. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Joy.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much. Any other citizens like to come forward and make comment on an item not on the agenda? Please come forward, state your name, and sign in for the record. Seeing none, we will move ahead then. Councilor Whiting?
Make a motion to open a public hearing.
On 6A?
6A, currency exchange licenses.
And Counselor Lehman?
Second.
I have a motion of open a public hearing and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, motion carries. Public hearing is now open.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. The reason we're here tonight is we have received a letter from the state of Minnesota in request of a resolution passed by Council for a currency exchange license. This is generally routine, but state law requires us that the municipality approves it before they go ahead and improve it on their level. They generally give the license out. So we have advertised for this meeting and soliciting any comments from the community about DRM LLC of Shakopee, which is known as XL Pawn. They do currency exchange. Otherwise, if there's nobody here, then you'll be able to, whatever, take your action. Okay.
Questions of staff? If not, thank you. Would the applicant or their designate like to come forward and make comment on the application? The applicant? If not, would any resident like to come forward and make comment on this application? This is a public hearing. Counselor Lehman?
Motion to close the public hearing.
Motion and second by Counselor Luce. And further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, motion carries. Public hearing is now closed. Counselor Whiting?
Make a motion to approve resolution number 7802, a resolution approving of DRM LLC, a Shakopee doing business as XL Pawn, 450 West First Avenue, for a currency exchange license.
I have a motion, and I have a second by Counselor Lewis. Discussion, looks like everything's in order here. This is an annual thing. Yep. Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, motion carries. Thank you very much. Moving ahead then to a public hearing, 6B, assessment on delinquent refuge bills. Counselor Lehman?
Make a motion to open a public hearing.
I have a second by Counselor Whiting. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, public hearing is now open. Mr. Reynolds?
At this point, we can close the public hearing, Mayor, because the individuals in question have satisfied their obligations, and we no longer need to have the public hearing.
Excellent. Good news. Counselor Lehman?
Do we have to ask if there's any citizens that want us to make comment?
This is a public hearing. Would anybody like to come forward and make comment on this issue? Please come forward, state your name and address for the record. This is a public hearing. Counselor Lehman?
Seeing none, I'll make a motion to close the public hearing.
Second.
I have a motion by Counselor Lehman, a second by Counselor Luce. Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Those opposed, motion carries. Thank you very much. And Counselor Whiting?
I'll offer a resolution number 7807, a resolution certifying assessments for delinquent refuse bills. Move its adoption.
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second, but point of order. I believe there is no action needed because it's been resolved. Counselor?
Mr. Mayor, Ms. Counsel, Darren, has the resolution been adopted?
The resolution would have been adopted tonight after the public hearing, but both of those residents have now paid.
And the resolution only applied to those two?
Those, okay. Right, to the outstanding ones. And so there's no outstanding, no outstanding issues, so.
We were gonna adopt a resolution of assessment, but both the parties involved in this public hearing for this assessment have paid or been, the issue's been resolved for both those.
Right.
Correct.
So therefore it makes the resolution a moot point.
Be assessing them zero.
Yep, and there's no motion needed.
I'll rescind that motion.
All right, got that? Thank you very much. Let's move forward now to item number seven. items removed from consent, and there are three items. There has been a request that we take these just slightly out of order, so I would like to start with 4E1, and Councilor Luce pulled this.
Yeah, we have some members of the audience that are going to present us with a nice sum of money, so thought it'd be a good time to get a picture and celebrate it.
Very good. Polly, do you want to make a comment?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council. We do here tonight have a couple on the resolution that have donated over $1,000, which was brought forward to, but specifically tonight, we have a very large one coming from RAR Corporations here in Shakopee, a $10,000 donation. So we have Mr. Jesse Tice here to present you the check. After you adopt the resolution, we'll take a quick photo opportunity. And just as a update on the fundraising, the committee has met their full obligation and have fully funded the project. The only thing that we are now raising a few more funds for is to complete the donor board. And I believe we are on our way to having that fully funded as well. So we're gonna start working on that donor board shortly so we have it ready for the spring for our grand opening. So after you adopt that resolution, we'll take a quick photo.
Councilor Luce?
You want me to make the motion?
I think it would be important to read the donors as well. I know one has been highlighted, but let's read them all. You don't have to read the whole
No, that's fine. The donators are RAR Malting for $10,000, CertainTeed St. Gobain Corporation for $1,000, Apple Autos Janus Fund, $1,000, and gentleman to my right here, I twisted his arm at the last meeting, and his company's going to throw in $1,000, so.
Would you like to make that in a motion then?
Yes. I'd like to make a motion to adopt resolution number 7808, a resolution of the City of Shakopee, Minnesota, accepting multiple donations of $1,000 or more for the Fund for All Playground, and move its adoption.
I have a motion on the table, and Councilor Lehman will second that. Further discussion on behalf of a thankful community. Thank you all to the donors. That's great. Further discussion? Discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? Motion carries. Thank you. Take a break for pictures, or you want to do the other one first?
Is the other one in the crowd?
Huh?
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Leadership.
When in doubt.
There wasn't. Just a nudge.
Yeah.
A good pause.
You got to get a receipt. Did you get a receipt?
Not in person.
All right.
We'll make sure they get a receipt.
Thank you very much. Let's move ahead then to the next one in order, or the next one out of order, 4E2. And Councilor Luce did pull this one as well, Councilor.
Yeah, this is a very large, very nice donation from the Rotary Club. I believe the value is just shy of $16,000. They did have some money sitting with the city to do this in a different park, and they are asking to have that put towards the Fun for All Playground, so hopefully we can make that work for them. And the musical deal up there, you got to hear it to believe it. I believe it's very much in tune. It's not junk. This is, you know, when you got an 8-foot xylophone that sounds good, you got something. So,
right. We have anybody from Rotary here tonight? Okay.
Actually, I have two members here.
Councilor?
Yes, I would like to make a motion to adopt Resolution 7809, a resolution of the City of Shakopee, Minnesota, accepting the donation of a Rhapsody music equipment for the Shakopee Fund for All Playground.
Second. Councilor Whiting, second that. Discussion. When I read this about Rotary, this is almost bittersweet because when we funded Huber Park, there was money left over for ongoing maintenance, and it's been that way for, you know, 10 plus years. Rotary had always thought about a music portion in Huber Park. Conversations years ago talked about it. It wasn't in the original build. It was going to be an add-on function. So this money's been sitting around, and kind of I look at the way parks are and the maintenance of parks and the replacement of parks are expensive and a little bit taking from one to another. But I do get it. The betterment of our parks overall, Huber Park still stands today, is in great shape. But to give that to the re-donate, I guess, or a transfer of donation, is great. And that now the music actually, it isn't going from one fund to another. The music is in place, and it is a great feature. But a little bit of history lesson for that, and those are my comments. Councilor Lehman?
The question I keep asking, my own mind is, did they donate the money to purchase it, or did they actually have something like this laying around? And if they did, that leads to a couple more questions, but it's a big raspberry, big brown thing, right?
Well, the features that were looked at for Huber Park were going to be, they weren't going to be freestanding like they are in this new playground. They were going to be musical features like that would be, it would have been put on the fence line, on the picket fence line, like a guitar with strings on it, and the kids would come by and go like this and then hear that. One was a big drum that you'd come and kind of bang on. There were three or four feature. One was more like a xylophone or where you could go like this and go zing. But they were going to be mounted on the fence. And they were expensive then. They're still expensive. This money was, the money left over was, that was a concept or something, and it was for maintenance for Huber Park. So,
so to answer my question, they donated the money to purchase these things? They didn't just have these things laying
around?
Well,
there wasn't enough money to do it all in their donation. I think of the $9,000, and I'd have a little history lesson here, but 70 to 80% of that money in there was Rotary's donation back then. There were some extra dollars, obviously, in the total fundraising that were left over. But Jamie?
Sure, I can just add, Mr. Mayor, members of council, just a few things. I did some research today on it. What happened when the Huber Park playground was put in is the Rotary Club had donated money to Huber Park, and then they decided instead of going directly to Huber Park, they put $30,000 originally that had gone to Huber Park, and then they increased it to $50,000 to go directly to that playground to actually purchase the rubber surfacing, which was a little over $42,000. So this is part of that as the leftover between the $50,000 they had donated and the $42,000 of the rubber surfacing meant to enhance the park in some way. And then to add on to that, I had been working with Mr. Berg about 2 years ago. We started talking about these musical features in Huber Park. We even had a concept plan that we laid out for the whole west side of Huber Park in between the parking lot and the picket fence of the playground where we were going to put this exact same features in. And then we kind of took our time doing that, and this park, the inclusive playground, came about, and we revisited it, and that's kind of where they decided, because of the sensory benefits and how it fit into the inclusive playground, that, and because we have the band shell at Huber Park, that maybe it was better to add these musical features to the inclusive playground. So it kind of worked out. They were able to enhance Huber with that rubber surfacing that they have there, which is amazing, and then now put that play feature in.
I did have dinner the other night with one of the former co-chairs of the Huber Park Community Build Playground, and in her comments that what the music concept, you know, was always kind of there. And the end goal here, as we see this resolution before us, is the music is now here. come listen to it. It's at a different location, but it's here rather than still being talked about. And that's kind of the unique part about it, how it all came together. Very thankful to Rotary for finishing off and getting done, and whether it would have been in Huber or the new playground, the music is here. Other comments?
I think it's a great fit for the inclusive playground, and as we know, things change, and so I believe it's probably in the right spot. So.
Councilor Lewis?
Yeah, and I think the Rotary did a very good thing. I believe this is going to have a sign on it in memory of their founder in Shakopee, Dr. Meralt. So very nice thing to do, and it's very well done.
Further discussion? Discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? Motion passes unanimously. Thank you very much. 4D, move on here to 4D1. And Councilor Lehman pulled this. Councilor?
Mayor, Council, I took it off consent because I got to tell you, this is a little bit backward to me. In 15 years that I've been in this chair, normally when we have three separate unions up for negotiations, and I guess they're due at the end of the year, by December we would already be, you know, halfway through the negotiations, figuring out, you know, where the give and take is, what they're asking for, what the city's willing to give, and so on and so forth. And we usually have periodic closed sessions with the council. It hasn't happened this year, which is just surprises me. But then I see this is the cost of living pay increase for non-union and part-time. This is basically telegraphing to the unions what to expect, and you know, if there's a Me Too clause in their contracts, well, they're going to get exactly what any action we take now. So this is just really foreign and backward to me, and it's the first time I've ever seen it done this way. So I'm really uncomfortable at this point.
Well, maybe we could have Ms. Gabbert further explain.
Well, if I may, Mr. Mayor. And I appreciate Councilor Lehman bringing this up a little bit before the meeting. Clearly, the council needs more information than what I'm used to giving in the jurisdictions I worked at before. So if you'd like, we can set this aside and bring it back later.
And since we're...
One meeting away?
Yeah, when's the actual union contracts up?
Well, they're up at December 31st, but that's not a... That doesn't mean that if we don't have it solidified by December 31st that everything stops.
Well, the essential police sergeants and patrol unions are not able to strike. Public Works could. They could if they wanted to. Nothing that stops them other than being nice guys and gals.
We've met with all three unions. We have good faith efforts of negotiating with them between now and the end of the year, but their contracts have all agreed that if we go through January, that they'll still apply to January, even though they expire in December. So there's still a good faith negotiation going on.
Can I ask how many negotiating meetings that you had?
We just had our first one with Public Works last Monday.
Okay, and Sergeant and Patrol?
Both have happened within the last 3 weeks.
Okay.
And more scheduled?
More will be scheduled between now and the end of the year.
Correct.
And how, I guess I'm just confused as to how do you know what you're negotiating is actually going to be supported?
Well,
if I may.
I mean, you know, probably not the right session for that.
Well, actually, we're pretty open about this, Councilor Lehman. And if you'll remember, when we brought forward our budget, we talked specifically about a 3% pay raise. We have nothing to suggest that that's not going to be something we can agree to. What we're talking about are some other ancillary things at the time. So it doesn't have to be an antagonistic relationship between us and the union. And frankly, we've worked it out very well at this point. Again, I think this jurisdiction has a lot more concerns, which I just found out about tonight, than I'm used to. Normally, in the places I worked before, administration puts those contracts together and then brings them before the body. Clearly, you want to have some more interaction. I understand that. The first I've heard of it, so we'll make sure to make that happen then.
I'm just telling you how it's been done all the time that I've been here.
Right. I think that you're asking for some action here of council. That's something that hasn't been agreed on with three other parties. And
well, no, that's not true, Mr. Mayor. What we're asking is to take a look and address the non-union issues, which we were clear about when we had our budget before the council and talked about. So, again, if council would like us to have them a little more involved in the front end, which, again, I'm not used to. My first time with this council in regards to union negotiations, but if that's what council likes, we'll make that happen.
That's what I would prefer.
Is your questioning here only to the non-union? Or to the union, excuse me?
Well, anything that we do with the non-union, morally and fairly, we would be doing with the union, I would assume. I mean, you're not going to give the unions a 5% pay increase and the non-unions 2%. It just doesn't seem nice.
Mr. Thompson?
I will say real quick, Mr. Thompson, if I may, we don't see an issue here. I think that as we talk with our union partners, we are comfortable with that based upon, because frankly, if I thought that there was going to be an issue, when we talked about this during the budget process, I thought that that might have been brought up, but there was no discussion on that at that time. So,
well, and given where we're at with negotiations and seeing the outcomes of the first meeting, the comfortability around what we're doing here tonight is absolutely there.
Councilor Lehman.
You know, it's just my character, so don't take it wrong. I happen to be a blunt, straightforward person. But with the information, I mean, with the no information that I have, I'm not able to be in the position that you are to say that I don't have any issue because I have no knowledge whatsoever of what's going on, okay? And I don't feel comfortable with that. And I don't mean it to be negative.
How did you do it last year? Or the year before, or the year before?
Staff would come before us. We would have a closed-door session. You can ask any council member that's been here. Jay's been here a while. We'd go into closed session for labor negotiations. They would say, you know what, we talked to all unions. This one wants, you know, this X, Y, and Z. We don't have a problem with that. This one wants this. We don't really like that. We're trying to go this way with it. So on and so forth. What's council want to do? The majority of council say we'd like to see this, this, and this. And they'd go back and tell them they'd really rather do this than that. And, you know.
As a reminder, we just finished up our first meeting with the last union on Monday.
On Monday.
So we're not there yet with the union. But again, I understand where you're coming from. This is the first I heard about it this
totally
evening.
Totally foreign to me.
Well, it's a different kind of a year. My role is new. I am new, being here 6.5 months, starting negotiations, took its time to be able to get us where we are today.
Mr. Mayor.
Councilor.
Mr. Mayor, if the council as a body would feel more comfortable not taking action on this matter till you had an update on the labor negotiations, it would be appropriate for you to schedule that at your next meeting. You could go into closed session, get an update on the labor negotiations, and then decide whether you want to act on this. So you could handle both items at your next meeting if you chose to do so.
I don't see an issue. This is the non-union portion of it. This
right.
is not contract negotiations.
I understand that.
We've talked about it in the budget, but if it's going to be moot anyway, if we decide to move forward, I don't see it as an issue. No one's going to lose any pay on this.
And my other point would be, if this was non-union, could approve this portion today. Doesn't we're not approving the non-union.
Well, here's
there's a telegraph aspect.
There's a Me Too clause.
Yeah. If we adopt this, it's guaranteeing the same to the unions. Yep. So you're telegraphing.
But we've really already done that throughout our budgeting process as well.
Been very open and honest
well,
with everybody.
I don't see it that way. I see the budget as we put this much in there.
Up to.
Mean that's automatically you're going to get the full boat.
No, you but know, we're using that as a guide to be able to
do that with projects. We put aside $2.1 million for a road recon. If it comes back at, you know, 1.75, we don't say, nope, got to spend some more. There's a little more left in the budget. At least I hope we don't operate that way.
3%
well, like I said, the first I heard of it this evening, my recommendation is that we pull it, and Ms. Gabber and I will sit down with council in a closed session, update you where we are in the negotiations, and then we can move forward from there.
What's the appropriate motion to table it?
I would say continue it to the next meeting.
Make a motion to continue it to the next meeting.
All right, I have a motion.
Second.
And a second, so the motion is to continue the 2017 pay resolution plan to our next meeting on December 20th. Discussion, discussion, discussion. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Thank you very much. That completes our consent business. Moving forward to 8A1. And Michael will present.
Mayor, this is, and Council, this is changes to the Land Development Code to incorporate some of the things we've discussed in the past, which is making the development process a little more transparent by allowing neighborhood people to know what's going on in a property, and also requiring neighborhood meetings so that prior to a project coming forward to the Planning Commission or to you, there's been a public meeting in the area.
Okay, questions of staff? As I read this, Michael, I wrote down that it seems like this is good policy. We're increasing the feet or yards of notification from 350 to 500?
Mayor and Council, yes, the state, we were at the minimum under state statute. We thought expanding a little bit further would let more people know what's going on. Also, when people are in the neighborhood and they drive by and see a sign on the property, there's going to be a note about what it's about. So if it's a subdivision, it will say that, and then it'll have the date of the public hearing so that people are informed.
And then, so the notification as well as signage, right?
Yes, sir.
And I know that in our community, we've talked about signage for 20 years. Never been implemented, so I thought that was good. And then my other comment was, is this going to be a requirement to have a neighborhood meeting or just strongly suggested?
Mayor and Council, it's a requirement unless it's waived by the zoning administrator. So there are some projects where there is no neighborhood. So it's likely, for instance, we had a conditional use at the old Kmart distribution building. We would likely waive that neighborhood meeting because there's no residential within 500 feet of that property.
I over the years, I have really grown to appreciate neighborhood meetings. It allows a developer to put his face out in front of the public or the impact, or big or small. And it's a great sounding board. And actually, I've seen where developers or change in use or something actually gets good information from the residents and takes actions to make their application even better. So that's good. And those are my comments that I think this is a good policy. Councilor Lehman?
Currently, the city is required to do a public hearing on most of these items, mm-hmm. if not all these items. Mm-hmm. So we're already required to make notification to surrounding property owners.
And we're expanding that.
So now we're doing it twice?
Mayor,
or are we turning our responsibility on to somebody else?
There's two requirements here. One is you do a neighborhood meeting as the applicant. So we will provide you with the address labels. You're supposed to send those out as the applicant and certify that you've done that. Hold the neighborhood meeting. Let us know prior to the Planning Commission meeting or the Board of Adjustment meeting what the outcome was of that neighborhood meeting. We notify again at the 500-foot radius officially through a legal notice and by mail of the application.
So we're doing it twice.
We're doing it once. The applicant's doing it once.
Right. We're doing it twice on the same project. Okay. And then we're going to require here's what I don't like about it. In a time when we have national elections where 70% say less regulations, we're doubling up on ours. Okay, I get the neighborhood meeting aspect. I actually like that portion of it, but I don't think it should be a requirement. It should be a suggestion. And I know that the thought is that somebody comes before a public hearing and a lot of these issues are already floated up from the neighborhood meeting. If they're not, the onus goes on to the applicant. If you were the applicant and it was a public hearing and there's all these concerns, if you couldn't address them, I would say either you're going to give us an extension needed to follow up on this stuff, or if you don't want to do that, we can just deny your application. So the onus is actually on them to try to do their job, because they're putting us in a position to not be able to approve it because we can't mitigate all the concerns. As far as the signage and increasing the distance, you're almost putting the applicant in a position to where, imagine putting signs up on a property saying, this is going to be the future, you know, pizza parlor or whatever. Now you're going to have not only the neighbors from the area that should be the ones involved, but you're going to have the general population getting involved when they don't really have a stake in issues that could be detrimental to the neighborhood. Okay, they're going to show up at these meetings and say, I think the pink would look much better than blue on the building, or could you put a fence here? And I could see the applicant saying, you know, we could put a fence over here that would take care of your issue there, and then turn around and find out later, no, you said you won't let me put a fence up there, so now I made an enemy because I promised something I can't deliver on. So I see some issues with this, and I'd like to see us move more toward less regulations instead of more regulations. I do think the neighborhood meeting aspect would be a good suggestion. I don't think mailing twice. You know, maybe we modify our process to where the mailing goes out, that there's going to be a public hearing, and in that initial mailing, you put in there's a neighborhood meeting on this topic prior to the public hearing at this location. Then you have one mailing, neighborhood meeting, and a public hearing.
Mayor, Councilmember Lehman, my experience, since I've been doing this a long time, is that the applicant sends out their information about their project to the neighborhood. It's not just a notice saying, come to my meeting. We have state mandated requirements for the public notice. So there are two different things. One is one we're required by state statute. The neighborhood meeting is really for the applicant to let the neighborhood know that the meeting, that they're having a meeting concerning their project, and it's up to them. We don't create that letter or form. They send it out basically informing the public from their standpoint what they think is important. To regards the sign, some projects, the 500 feet should be 5,000 feet. The whole idea behind that is on larger projects that have a bigger impact, people that might be just outside that 500 feet or the 350 that we have right now will have some idea what's going on in the neighborhood. We hear time and time again at the Planning Commission meetings that stuff's going in down the street and I didn't get notified. This makes it completely transparent so that people know what's going on.
Councilor Whiting.
Thank you. I totally disagree. Sorry. I think the idea of having a meeting that the applicant provides is a way to get that information out. I've always liked the idea of having a sign out in front of these properties, and we've talked about that on a couple of other, I think it was park issues, but I think it makes a lot of sense. There's always people in town that are questioning what's going in or what's going to happen with that property when they see some trucks or some surveyors out there possibly or anything, and a lot of misinformation that comes up and about. So I don't see it as more regulation. I see it as more transparency, more communication, more ability to get public input and have a good project and a chance to make these things a success. So I like the recommendations here. And don't see an issue with it.
Councilor Lehman?
Didn't I read in here that the city was going to do the mailing for the neighborhood meeting and that the city would supply the signs?
The city supplies the signs. The applicant has to put them up and give us a notarized statement that they've been installed.
City's going to supply the listing for the mailing and do the mailing.
City does a state-required mailing for the public hearing.
Right.
The applicant, we will give them the labels. I mean, right now the process is we require the applicant to go to a title company, pay for those labels, have the title company prepare them, and then send out the public notice. What we're trying to do is we have that capability in our own GIS system. So instead of requiring the applicant to go to a title company, we can give them those labels.
You know, I think transparency, more information, more notice. I live adjacent to where Hy-Vee is going. I didn't get noticed. I don't know how long my cul-de-sac is. It's going to impact my neighborhood.
2 feet.
Huh? 2 feet. I remember when there was a going to be a truck service center over by where Amazon was years ago. And the notification people were coming out of the woodwork that I didn't know about this. And truck traffic, and boy, why didn't we have more people know about this? When we had a lot more vacant land and fewer on the fringe area had rezoning, it'd be great. I've seen other communities. This property is proposed to be rezoned. Those are impact related, if it's an upzone or a downzone. I think we're doing our community betterment of good policy by trying to be more transparent. Councilor Luce?
I've been to a few of these meetings, these neighborhood meetings with these companies, and it does air out a lot of issues and brings a lot of good information forward. I kind of lean to the less government deal, just make it a suggestion and not a mandate, but just explain to them how much this helps them and then let them do it.
Councilor Lehman?
One thing in the name of transparency and accountability that just blows my mind and has for years is it's really easy to talk about it, but when you have a appointed citizen group, nothing personal against the Planning Commission, Board of Adjustments, but when you have appointed individuals that aren't held responsible in the electorate process, making decisions on variances and conditional use permits, and the only way that the actual citizen of Shakopee can go around that process is if you pay the city to be able to go before your elected body and get your representation. To me, that's absolutely wrong. That's just totally wrong. You could have a citizen of Shakopee asking for a variance of the Planning Commission and get denied. In order for them to come to the council on that topic, they have to pay to appeal it. They have to pay to have their elected representatives represent them. That's wrong in our style of government. And this is as
how does that relate to this action before us?
Well, because now you have the Planning Commission, which is doing the preliminary plats, comp plan amendments, PUDs, all of these things that go before the Planning Commission, and some before us, but you're asking a applicant to have two layers of government regulations, a lot of it at their expense, and then we turn around and say, geez, we want economic development. Oh, let's give them an incentive, a financial incentive to do this when we just put a financial burden on them. Doesn't make any sense.
Mr. Reynolds.
I think if you think about all the problems you've ever had with a particular development, almost 75% of them have to do with a lack of notice. And then where you have people that come in here and say, we had no idea that this action was happening. And it's went through all these steps and suddenly, and then they motivate, and then they come in here and they try to convince you not to move forward with it. The purpose of this is to make sure everybody understands what the project is and make sure that they understand from the beginning and have an opportunity to come to a meeting and say, hey, what is it that you're planning on doing and how is that going to impact me? That's what this is all about. It's to alleviate some of those pinch points that we traditionally have in this process. If the council doesn't want to do that, that's fine. But again, the purpose of it is to make things easier for not only the public to understand what's going on, but this process as a whole, and to make it work better, to try to grease the skids, if you will, to, if there are going to be objections, we all would like to know about it from the beginning. And I'm sure the developer would like to know about it from the beginning so they don't waste hundreds of dollars as part of a process that ends up going nowhere.
Councilor Lehman.
Normally, what we're trying to do is change the process. What normally happens is a person or a company takes a piece of property. If it's zoned properly for the use that they want to put on it, we by law cannot deny that application.
If they don't need a variance, okay. If it's a permitted use.
So now we're opening it up to try to get everybody and their brother to complain about something on a proposal that's 100% legitimate and legal. That we can't deny.
Mayor and Councilman,
now,
that's
let me,
not
let
true.
Let me continue.
That's not what's occurring.
Let me continue. There are within that development opportunities for people that could be affected within a distance to say, I'm concerned about noise, I'm concerned about hours of operation, I'm concerned about light wash, I'm concerned about real issues from that development that could affect them being in that vicinity. The idea isn't to try to get these potential problems to stop the process. The idea is to find solutions to mitigate them problems.
That's why we have leadership and okay? have these meetings.
But for a point of clarity, if there's a permitted use, Mayor and Council, they won't be going to the Planning Commission. If it's a plat, it'll just come here.
Unless
permitted uses. This is
for
items that are requiring
impact.
Public hearings, so that public hearing would happen. So to give you a good example, some of the items you just mentioned, if it were a grocery store and they didn't hold a public meeting, they show up, people adjacent may say, well, what about the light wash in my yard? Or what about landscaping? I think the benefit of a public meeting and requiring it is it's to everyone's advantage to get all those issues, because developers often feel they know everything and neighborhoods often feel they know everything. By getting them around a table in a non-approval process, confrontational area, it works pretty well. And I have done a lot of these where we've changed the rules so that there's a requirement for the public meeting. I have never had a developer complain about that requirement, because at the end, sometimes they go, you know what? I didn't have to go to the city council because this is not going to be supported by the neighborhood and I don't want to go through that, or I'm going to change my project. I had a developer who was going to do a 24-hour store. Well, he had the neighborhood meeting. There wasn't one person of the 200 people that showed up. They all loved the project. They didn't want a 24 hours. And he went, if they love it that much, we won't do a 24-hour store. And that, if that had to occur at the Planning Commission or a city council meeting, it probably would not have gone that well. It came, it was supported 100% by the neighborhood.
Like I said, I'm not against the neighborhood meetings. I think it's a good idea. I don't like it mandated.
Councilor Lewis, did you have more? Okay. Councilor Whiting?
I'll offer ordinance number 951, an ordinance of the City of Shakopee amending Title 15 of the City Code by adding new sections 150.022 and 151.018 relating to common procedures for zoning and subdivision applications.
I have a motion on the table. Second for discussion point.
Okay. No, I told you I don't like the mandate.
I'll second it for discussion.
Mayor, I think a lot of the bigger developments, the ones with the larger impacts, already have it built into their model, like Hy-Vee and others, and already do these neighborhood meetings. So I think the real kicker is going to be for the very small conditional use permit type variance. I just can't imagine a very small variance of a residential lot going through all of this. It's more than what the end product is worth.
It gives an opportunity, though. Mr. Reynolds said, you've been involved in the community a lot. I didn't know about that, or I didn't hear about that. I believe in a public hearing for our community, for a notification in the newspaper. If you don't subscribe to the newspaper, is 10 days. 12 days? How many days? City Clerk, a notification for a public hearing. Huh?
10 days.
At least 10 days. If you don't get the paper, I didn't know. Oh, we had a big meeting. Nobody showed up. I think we're actually doing the public a favor here and our community by at least being more out front with information so they can participate in the process. Councilor Lewis?
Well, not that I, like you have already voiced my disapproval, but I'm going to move this along and I'll vote for it. Only for the fact it's going to only be brought back to us, and the three of you will, the one missing, will vote it in. So, just for expediency.
So, how do we deal with a simple, small residential property variance where now you're going to take a family, a single family, and put them through this great big giant monster twice? It's crazy.
Mayor and Council, I would suggest that staff is reasonable. I mean, I think that we're going to look at items and see what the impact is. If it's a driveway or something like that, it's not likely going to have a big impact. But we've had instances I'm told by staff over the years, where you want to put your garage closer to the sidewalk and no one thought it was an issue. And then everyone shows up and goes, how come he's gotten to do that and I didn't get to do that? Why, you know, why is that? So I think we'll have to look at them. My suggestion would be let's do it for a year and see how it goes and come back in a year and give you a report.
So,
and we're happy to make the changes or make it non-mandatory if we find that it's causing a hardship.
That was going to be my suggestion, is we get an opportunity to try this. We can always bring this back and say, you know, this is just crazy. We can't handle this. Let's change it back to the way we had it. It's out of hand. But I would rather err on the side of having more communication and more transparency and having more people at least know what's going on than putting something up that says, you know, no, we don't want anybody to know what's going on, and continue with the process of not having having people upset about things that they don't know about. So I'm saying we could try this.
Councilor Lehman, I wrote on my form here, good policy. But we're all right. It's like a variance. If you write a policy about a variance and all of a sudden in a year you get hit a lot, maybe something's wrong with that rule. And you come back and modify it. If there's a variance in that and it upholds time after time, you know, that's a good policy. But I think you're right, maybe on the small things that shouldn't, this is, I wouldn't call it an encumberment, but certainly in some of the bigger issues in our community, more notification would be better. Councilor Lehman?
I go down this list, PUD, that's a pretty big deal. Don't have a problem with that requirement. Preliminary plat, usually it's a pretty large plat. Doing a plat, final plat, preliminary plat, that's usually a pretty big deal. Amending the comp plan, rezoning, that's a pretty big deal. I get it. Conditional use permit, variance, no, not unless it's a pretty big deal. You know, I keep hearing this, how we'll bring it back. That's like saying that the sunset transportation tax is going away. Come on, really? That ain't never going to happen. We've got 70% of the country that says we want to get rid of some regulations, and we're going to do exactly the opposite. It's just not representative of the people.
Can I offer maybe you want to amend the motion and say that you know, possibly residential or conditional use permits on a smaller scale are left up to the discretion of the planning director or something like that in the ordinance? Or
same with the variances.
Well, variances, I think, is residential variances. Yep. If you want to write, if it's a commercial or industrial,
well,
I think you want
to
see that.
Yeah, if it's a big project, I don't have a problem with it.
All right.
You know?
So you're offering an amendment to your motion?
I would suggest if Mr. Lehman would want to offer an amendment.
You were
since
the,
he has
well,
a concern.
Okay, I see all of that.
I would say that if it was required on larger, it should be required on larger projects. And it should be suggested on smaller projects, and that smaller individual variances and conditional use permits.
Would you go with the residential variances?
Yep. And, I'd even go further than that, because some of the variances come forward with staff dealt with them and bring forward on consent agenda that city's going to, you know, release this variance that we hold on this property. It's no big deal, you know. So if they feel that it's a big deal, residential is probably one that they could use a lot of discretion on, but staff uses their discretion in the past on some of these variances in alleys that no longer exist and stuff like this. So I don't have a problem with that either. I just want to loosen it up some on the real small stuff, because it's going to be overburdening on them.
Well, I'm trying to word amendment to the motion, otherwise be trusting of staff, but... That's where Councilor Whiting was going.
Well, and right, and how do I word that?
Oh, there we go.
Well,
Councilor.
Mr. Mayor, Mr. Councilor, this is an ordinance. So if you want some changes made, it's going to be very difficult to draft them right here at this table. For example, adding we want neighborhood meetings for large projects but not small projects, we would have to define that. I mean, if the council as a body wants this tweak somehow, we need some time to tweak it, because it is an actual ordinance amendment that's going into your city code.
Michael?
Mayor and council, I would suggest that under neighborhood meeting, it says unless a waiver is granted by the zoning administrator, which is me, and I think that you've given us pretty clear direction and to the administrator that if it's a small thing, we're probably going to waive the neighborhood meeting unless there's some neighborhood issue that comes up.
Right here.
That was the reason for putting that in there, so that we would have some flexibility,
yep. Right.
So that we didn't have to define what a large project was.
I'd like to see it more defined. I mean, that puts you in a bad predicament. Somebody could say, oh, they got a waiver, I didn't. You could point out the differences of the projects and the all this, and they're still going to be mad. So let's just send it back, define it, bring it back, and then we'll adopt it.
Well, there's a motion on the table and a second. Further discussion? Discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed?
Aye.
Motion fails.
And just real quickly, Mr. Mayor, and I understand Councilor Lehman's concerns, but essentially, that's what we get paid for. You know, we have to make those tough calls on occasion, and you know, I have every confidence that Mr. Kursky can make those calls, and we're not always going to be correct in those calls, but we will have the guidance. We understand where you're coming from as a body. And, you know, the point is not to make something burdensome for a process that it doesn't need to be. The point is was to try to make some notice so people understand what it is that's happening in their neighborhood.
Councilor Lehman?
The reason we don't have speed limit signs that say speed limit, no number, is because it leaves it open to discretion of what actually is right and wrong. They put a number there for a reason so that people actually know what the threshold is. Okay? I like the black and white world so you know what the rules are. But I'd like to make a motion to direct staff to take the discussion we had here, incorporate it, and bring it back for adoption.
Second. I have a motion on the table and a second by Councilor Luce. Further discussion? Discussion, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, motion carries. We'll see this back. Thank you very much. Moving forward to 8B1, acceptance of a donation from Emerson. Ms. Polly will present.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council. Not sure how to follow that discussion, but bringing forward you this tonight, this is something that has been brought forward to about a year ago as just a general discussion in a memo when we were doing the design and planning of Quarry Lake Park, and we were deciding of whether or not to go forward with putting the building in to that phase one construction or postponing it to a later date. So last year when we were planning Quarry Lake Park, Emerson came to the table. They're very interested in the development of Quarry Lake Park, being that it's their neighbor. They see it as a great amenity to the city. They want to see it enhanced, so they made a pledge at that time to donate $500,000 to the city over 5 years to go towards this building. Now, council has not decided to move forward with the building at this time. We do have it on our park reserve plan for 2018. That's all dependent upon park reservation or park reserve funds coming in from development. So what this is, though, is bringing forward, it's a request from Emerson to accept the donation now, because like I said, it's $500,000 over 5 years. So they had budgeted in their fiscal year in their charity contributions for each fiscal year, $100,000 starting in 2016, since we discussed this in 2015, starting in 2016 for the next 5 years. For their purposes, they would like to donate it because it's allocated this year. There's not a guarantee or a possibility that it would be guaranteed if we don't take it now. So they're wanting to donate it ahead of time to have the city hold on to it in a fund designated specifically for Quarry Lake Park in this building. With included in your packet is a term sheet that we had put together. We actually put this together in 2015 that had a few extra amenities or I guess benefits to Emerson that gave them certain discounts and in addition to the naming rights of the building and such. Emerson has since come back and say they cannot accept anything other than the naming rights because it's a charitable contribution, so there will be no specific meeting dates for them. There'll be no discounts to their employees. Nothing extra will be going to Emerson other than this donation, and then because we'll use it as a sponsorship at the time the building is built for that naming rights of 25 years. So what we're asking tonight is that we accept the first installment of $100,000 this year, with them to donate over the next 5 years that $500,000, with the term sheet that if the city chooses not to move forward with the building and build it by 2019, that we return those funds to them. Talking with Mr. Nelson, our finance director, we can hold this in our park reserve. It is a revolving fund that we can earmark it for. It can be returned if we decide not to go back. But if we decide not to take this donation and then we do decide to go with the building, there's a lesser chance that we would ever get them to don't be able to donate it because they may have earmarked their money for other contributions.
All right, thank you. Questions of staff?
Two questions. The first question is the $500,000 over 5 years doesn't work out to be $2.5 million? Darn.
I know.
The second question is the city will include a budget of $5,000 for Emerson approved signage. Is that something they're allowed to accept?
It is. Yeah. And that's very basic when we were talking about signage on the building.
That's their naming rights signing?
Their naming rights, yep.
Other questions of staff? If not,
One more. What was the, at the beginning of the Quarry Lake process, what was their commitment dollar amount? Is it the same as this or?
It is the same, yes.
Now they're just saying, before I think it was, you know, I think there was a somewhat of an unspoken deadline coming up.
There was
up.
6 months that they had given us at a year ago. Actually, the memo was just about a year ago. They had given us that the donation offer was good for 6 months, and they have graciously extended that and brought it forward and would like to give it now.
Councilor Whiting.
Offer resolution number 7810, a resolution of the City of Shakopee, Minnesota, accepting a donation from Emerson for Quarry Lake Park and move its adoption.
Yeah. Motion on the table.
Second
by Councilor Lehman. Discussion. Councilor Luce.
Ms. Pauley, how many broken windows in the parks have we had in the last 2 weeks?
10.
And what kind of a dollar cost was on that?
That I do not have. That goes to Parks Department.
It's less than 3,000. That's what I know. But yeah, we're going to get them fixed. It's not.
Yeah, no, I know we're going to get them fixed. I'm just, my point is that the building that I've seen that planned for this area, there's an awful lot of glass, and that building is out in the middle of virtually nowhere. It'd be a great opportunity. I believe that most of the windows were shot out from the parking lot, so they never even got out of the vehicle, just drove by. And
yeah, I'm not sure it was, the police have it, they're working on it, and they do have kind of a reward out there for anybody who has information about this pellet gun shooter for our windows. But we do have the opportunity, we will revisit this building when we're going to build it. We'll look at those plans. The plans are 80% complete. I can't tell you exactly what the glass is, if we had tempered glass in the plans or not, or maybe not tempered is the right, but if we have bulletproof or anything like that. But that could be something that we add to the design as we finalize that when we're ready to construct it. So.
And this, we have, as a council, decided to move these dollars for this building out of the CIP for 2017, is that correct?
Correct, it's in 2018 at this point.
Councilor Lantman, oh, I'm sorry. Councilor Luce?
I was wondering if some discussions with Emerson for maybe turning a few of their security cameras towards that park in the future, so that if the building would have some cameras on it, that would help if anything happens.
We haven't discussed that, we can keep that in mind. We've also discussed the potential for some of our parks to have remote cameras that would go on a citywide camera system that we've been working on for our city buildings. We haven't gotten that far yet, but there is possibility.
Ms. Pauley, any acceptance of this donation does not assure in any way the building gets built or ties any future council to it.
Correct, yep. Basically, the term sheet just says that if we do not construct it by 2019, giving us a year from the date we currently have it on the books, that we return that donation back to Emerson.
I didn't see anything on there about paying interest on any of the money we return either, so we're good to go.
There is a motion on the table. There is a second. Further discussion? Accept the money and wait and see and go from there. Thank you. Any further discussion? Discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Those opposed? Motion carries. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Moving ahead then to 8C1, the 2017 budget and property tax levy public meeting. Mr. Nelson will present.
Good evening, Mayor, Council members. Give me one second here.
This is not a public hearing.
This is not a public hearing. This is a public meeting.
I see that.
So they made the change a number of years ago. They changed it from a public hearing to a public meeting, per se. So we don't have to post it officially like you do a public hearing. It's
so that transparency thing again.
But well, we do notify the public. We do notify the public in their truth and taxation statements that they all received in November. So
thank you, Darren.
And at our preliminary budget meeting as well, or tax levy, we notify them at that point. So. So welcome. Tonight is the presentation of the 2017 budget and tax levy, and it is, like I mentioned, the public meeting where the public will have an opportunity to discuss the budget and the tax levy. The City of Shakopee annually adopts a general fund budget and property tax levy for the upcoming year. Tonight is that public meeting where the public has an opportunity to comment on the budget and levy, as I mentioned earlier. So how did we get to this point? The 2017 budget process began earlier this summer, so it's changed a little bit this year compared to prior years. We began working on the CIP this summer with budget work session, I believe it was in July, working on the 2017 through 2021 capital improvement plan, often referred to as the CIP. And that CIP is an updated final version, is included in the budget document that's attached to your agenda tonight as well. From there, we went on to a preliminary budget and levy that was approved in September. That preliminary levy was used to prioritize, size, and shape the 2017 budget. In addition to that meeting, we also had work sessions in prior to that preliminary budget meeting. We had a work session earlier part of September, and then now in November, we had another work session as well, looking over the kind of the preliminary budget or the draft budget at this point in time. The budget process has changed, and there will be more future changes. As Administrator Reynolds has pointed out, that this is going to be now it's probably a two-year process. Originally, it was a two to three-year process. Well, we're kind of through that year one, and we have made some changes to that document. And really, it's there for transparency purposes that we've mentioned throughout the night, and accountability. We want the public to be able to look at our document and understand where our dollars or where their dollars are going. And that is often difficult looking at any city budget. The goal is, let's change that, turn it upside down, turn it on its head, and provide them with something that is readable and understandable and useful to both staff and residents. So a couple of those transformations that began this year were the budget calendar. In prior years, a lot of our budget work, to my understanding, has been completed by about the summertime or so, that July-August timeframe. That preliminary levy, everything would have been kind of wrapped up per se at that point in time. That's great. That's one way to do it. Another way to do it is kind of how we did this year, is that we kind of delayed that a little bit. We sized the budget in the summer. We found out what our priorities are, found out what those big budget issues were, found out what kind of dollars we're going to need, and then whittled it down from there. What that does provide is it helps us gain a few more months of actual history for the current year. So we're projecting 2017. It's nice to have a few more months in 2016 to see how things are actually going for this year, if we implemented a new program, or if we have new changes, or if it's a snowy winter or a rainy summer or something to that nature. We're able to get a few more months of data in our current year to help us with our projections for the following year. The 2016 or the budget also includes a revised 2016 budget. The revised budget serves as the city's kind of final budget for the year. Due to the general nature of budgeting and unforeseen circumstances can now be accounted for with this revised budget. So if we have a spike in fuel where it goes from $2 a gallon to $4 a gallon, we're able to come back to the council and say, hey, you know, we budgeted it at $2 a gallon. We didn't see OPEC shutting the pipe off. Now it's $4 a gallon. We're going to come back to you and get that clarification or approval. We also have the transparency of the levies. In the past, we've all only had just basically a general fund levy and a debt service levy. Now we have a direct levy for a capital improvement fund, where in the past we've transferred funds from the general fund over to the capital improvement fund. Now the capital improvement fund is standing on its own. It'll have a dedicated levy along with some of the franchise all the franchise fees that we had passed earlier this year. Then also we have the tightening of the budget variances. We've had some pretty significant budget variances in the past. It's been a pretty loose process on how we've estimated our revenues and our expenditures. We're really tightening that up quite a bit and really just budgeting for what we need and not just budgeting on top of a budget. So we do have many positives to build upon. First of all, we've talked about strong building and construction permits the whole year. Looking at our monthly financial review, those construction and building permits have come in well above our budget. That's provided new additional tax capacity that's helped keep our tax rates modest. The flexibility from those past budget variances has provided us some flexibility. We've been able to do some things that normally we wouldn't be able to, and we probably won't be able to do in the future. And then the implementation of the franchise fee as well has been able to diversify our revenue base. So our challenges looking forward, we filled a number of open positions, and the tightening of the budgets will decrease any variances we have. So we don't have the luxury of just being able to shift dollars one way or another because we have three or four open positions or we have excess dollars budgeted. It's going to have to be accounted for now. Then obviously the bond issuance for the community center and ICE arena, that $29.5 million bond issuance was added to our balance sheet, and we need to pay for that. And then we also have a little bit of the distrust from last year's the school referendum that I believe the message was that it was going to come out at X dollars, and it came out at 2X. That was a little bit, I think, kind of delved into that issue a little bit, and I think it was a little bit of the timing issue with market values and such, too. So I think they got a little bit bitten there, but we still have to contend with that. You know, so we have a big bond issuance coming online. What's the impact going to be to our residents? So looking at the tax levy for 2017, we're seeking an increase of $1.3 million or 7.47%. That's the amount that we've come out with at our preliminary levy, and that amount hasn't changed to this point in time. This increase in levy is fully directed towards existing and new debt service. Our new debt levy is increasing by $1.4 million, but yet our total levy is only increasing by $1.3 million. So to account for all of our operational increases with what we have for just general operational increases and adding $1.4 million of new debt service levy, our levy is only increasing $1.3 million. And it should be noted that that debt service levy includes the principal payment for the first year of the community center for 2018. So we levy that in 2016 for collection, 2017 for payment in 2018. And so that's kind of how that process works. It's kind of a three-year time frame there. But other levy changes include the abatement levies. In the past, the abatements that we've granted businesses coming into our community, those have been paid for out of our general fund surplus, out of our general fund tax surplus. And so now, with tightening up of our budgets, we need to isolate those abatements, and we are setting them aside in a separate fund. Each abatement has its own fund already, but we'll be isolating those abatements and making sure that they're accounted for. As I mentioned before, the Capital Improvement Fund now is a dedicated levy at $385,000. And as also mentioned in past years, the CIF or the Capital Improvement Fund was funded by transfers from the general fund. And last year, I believe, was $1.2 million. So the franchise fee revenues, along with that $385,000 levy, will account for that $1.2 million that have been transferred in the past. So here's a breakdown of our levy comparing 2016 to the 2017 proposed levy. You can see the general fund levy is actually decreasing by about $650,000. Abatements is going up by $175,000, but that's basically just pulling it from the top line, from the general fund line, down to this abatements line. So it's not a tax, basically tax neutral, it's just accounting for it separately. The capital improvement levy, there again, that was basically built into the general fund levy in the past years. Now that's isolated in its own separate line dedicated for capital improvement. And then the debt service, you can see it comes down to about $2.1 million or just about $2.2 million, or a change of $1.4 million from 2016 to 2017. And when you add those together, you get $1.3 million with a 7.47% tax increase.
Just to clarify for everybody, when we brought up the 2007B debt payment of 94, and the, what was the other one? 2012A?
2008, the one we were talking about earlier?
I can't find it here, but it's in the meeting minutes from our last meeting, and I talked to you before the meeting about it, and I think it's, we need to clarify it and make sure, I know it's right, because you, we kind of went over it before the meeting, but the general public may not be following along. It was, there was two 2007 bond debt.
Mr. Mayor, Councilmember Lehman, that was the, you see, you got the 2007B and the 2008A right below it. In our initial resolution at our preliminary budget meeting, we had the 2008A labeled as 2007B. So we had two of them that were 2007B. We made the correction at the council meeting to make that correction that it should be labeled 2008A. So what you see up here tonight is that correct levy allocation for that specific debt service line item. So the 148,800, as Councilor Lehman is pointing out, was labeled 2007B in the past, but we made that correction at the preliminary.
Has there ever been an effort during these bonds, the A, B, the improvement, refunding, to actually, for the public, identify what they were used for at the time? I know I've been in finance for a long time. I can probably guess what some of these are for, so could staff, but the public, oh, what did we do in 2008? You know, some of it is, you know, the street stuff, obviously, but it would be great to someday, you know, put a, oh yeah, that's for X.
That's a great suggestion.
You know, we had that during the budgeting process, right? Because I asked for it, I'm sure everybody else did, and staff gave it to us. But the 2004B at that meeting was also removed from 2017's proposal, which is not on there, so that's...
We're good?
We're good there, too.
Good.
Yep, that's good. Yep, we're good. I just wanted to make sure, because
yep.
It was confusing.
Absolutely, because we got to make sure we get the resolutions right, and we got to make sure we get the tax levy
correct. Otherwise,
we
have two resolutions on the books that are wrong, but I think we're right.
We're right, yep.
It's confusing because there's... How did they get to be the same number? That's a good question.
I think we had one fall off, and I think we were just moving things up, and we didn't change the title. So that happens. So looking at the tax impact, which is always what we want to know, 7.47% tax increase, you think that there's going to be a fairly substantial tax impact. And on the residential side of it, property values really remain very stable from January 2nd, 2015 to January 2nd, 2016. And those are the valuation dates that are used for your taxes that are payable in 2016 and 2017 respectively. So it gets confusing, but for our taxes payable in 2017, it's your value as of January 1st, 2016 or January 2nd, 2016. And the difference between those values from 16 to 15 remain very stable on the residential side of it. The average market value of our homes of a home here in Shakopee at $229,700 actually decreased to $229,100. But on top of that, we did have 8% increase in our tax capacity. So that was new commercial industrial business coming online that helped maintain our tax rate. So even with that 7.47% increase and our residential values remaining flat, we were able to keep our tax rate very, very modestly, a very modest increase. I think it was only 0.324%. So that's great on that end of it. The impact of the homes, it varies depending upon your home and the value of your home. You can see I got three different scenarios here. A home valued at $151,000, we'll see a $2 tax increase. Home valued at that $229,100, that average valued home, we'll see a $9 decrease. Let me,
that slide's inaccurate. My $150,000 house went up by more than $2.
And these are assessed average homes. So an individual specific home may go up or down, and it depends upon the neighborhood and such like that.
Well, that's all of them houses of that value combined, right?
Right. Okay. That's an average of homes that are about 100 parcels in that area. They saw about a $2 tax decrease. And then the homes at the higher value at about $330,000 will see a $31 tax decrease. And part of that is that the home's valued in that $100,000 to about $250,000 actually saw a little bit of gain in their value over that course of time. Whereas that the home's valued at $250,000 and above actually saw a little bit more of a decrease. And so as the home became more expensive, that decrease actually increased, that decrease became greater. I'm not gonna use decreased and increased back to back here, but.
That's one thing I was talking to the other day, we were talking to City Administrator Bill Reynolds. We were talking about the value, the amount of properties in a category of 100,000 to 149, and 150 to 199, two segments there. I think about 5,500 homes in that segment out of our entire properties in that category are in this list here is 11,000. It's about 40% of our homes are at 200 or less for this graph. I thought that was significant mm-hmm. for our community, both in value and how they're being taxed.
Right.
Mine was 3.8%.
Up?
Yes, at 150,000.
Okay. Your value or your tax?
My tax.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
You must have had a good year at your house.
Well, we tore down a couple walls. We threw the carpeting out. So, yeah, it's looking good.
So when you pull those building permits and then submit them to the county.
Oh, no, we just took the walls out. We thought we could lower the value. Didn't work.
Thank you, Darren. Proceed.
So is there any questions on this chart here on the distribution of the values and such? And it's really that value that's driving your taxes this year. With the tax rate remaining stable, it's the value that's really the trigger on whether your taxes are going up or down on that end of it. Looking at some of our, moving over from the tax levy over to the budget now a little bit, we have several budget impact issues that obviously affect us. And for any service industry, personnel expenditures are the largest category of type of expenditure that an entity is going to face, and the city of Shakopee is no different. We are looking at four new staff positions for 2017, and that's at a cost of about $184,000. We have one non-sworn investigative aide crime analyst position in the police department, and then we have three parks and recreation employees for the community center and ice arena, and that's obviously due to the expansion and need for additional service there on that end of it. The city's health insurance is going up about 10%, which is about $108,000. That's actually a good note. Initially, we were thinking it was going to be about 15%. So as bad as 10 sounds, 15 sounds worse. So on that end of it. And then the built-in COLA increase that we have right now is about $387,000 based off of the 3% that we've built into the budget at this point in time. So another budget impact issue is the internal charge restoration, and this is something we've talked about kind of starting with our CIP process this summer, is that the equipment, building, and park asset internal service funds, those rents that are charged out to each department were reduced by 20% back in 2014. The 2017 budget begins to restore those reductions by implementing a two-year phase-in plan for the equipment and the buildings. It was the council's direction for staff to look at the park assets and to implement the park asset rents back at 100% for this current year for 2017. And along with that, the park assets, we also looked at the actual assets within that item that were being charged rent. In the past, we believe it was just the park shelters themselves within the whole park system that were being charged a rent. And obviously within a park system, there are playground equipment, there are hockey boards, there's parking lots, there's numerous other things that really need to be maintained and replaced over time as well too. So we are now looking at the system-wide piece of that as well. So the budget impact on restoring some of those charges is $500,000, which is park assets is about $243,000, buildings $81,000, and then equipment's about $175,000 of that. So that has an impact on our budget. Other services and charges. So one thing that we changed with the budget process this year was providing departments with a lot of their fixed costs. In the past, finance department has provided them with their personnel numbers. We've done that this year as well, and we did that with the rents as well. And I said, okay, let's provide you with these fixed numbers that are out of your control, and then from there, you can do what your budget, what you want. It's their direction, their prerogative, but any of those additional costs are going to be held to a 0% increase. And so they had basically, after you get rid of your personnel costs, which are 70-75% of your budget, your rent charges, you have a pretty small little pot of money to divvy up amongst all your other charges and services and supplies that you need to account for throughout the year. And they had to do that on top of a 0% increase because we knew that we didn't have a whole lot of excess budget to play with or any excess budget to play with. As far as economic development is another budget impact, we have the third year of a $500,000 allocation to the downtown redevelopment project. So that'll be 2017's the last programmed year for that. We also have the exterior grant program, which is allocated an additional $130,000 from the revolving loan fund. That program has a balance of about $264,000. That was as of about August or September timeframe. In the past, transfers had come from the general fund to that program. This revolving loan fund had been kind of sitting idle for a number of years and had some funds in there that were originally established from the EDA. So we were allocating $130,000 of that, of those dollars back to this program. Then obviously debt service is a big one. Our annual debt service payments are $2.1 million. We look back at that levy sheet earlier, that's our total levy for debt service is 2.1. And due to the restructuring of our debt service, due to some debt service falling off in the next several years, we'll be able to maintain our existing levy for debt service at 2.1 for our current debt load. So it will not go up or down from where it's at until all our existing debt is paid for. So we won't have any more spikes in the debt service levy from here on out with existing debt.
I just want to, when this last line, due to available debt service funds and bond structure, the annual debt levy will remain stable. That is, in 2017 going forward, we won't see any spikes, but let's be perfectly sure that we saw a huge spike from 16 to 17, over $1.4 million.
Absolutely, Mr. Mayor. And it should be noted that the community center bond payment is 2.1 or just about 2.2 million. So, and we have the other debt service bonds that are out there as well too. So the way it's structured is that it's 2.1 million is what the levy is gonna be up on for existing debt service on that end of it. So we won't have another spike next year. You know, we won't have $400,000 or $500,000 of new debt service coming on for existing bond payments.
But realistically, we're gonna have more than 2.1 million in annual debt service. The community center is 2.1 by itself. And there's other outstanding bonds that we have that are debt. Some are dropping off.
Yep.
But you have other ones besides the community center.
No, not. It's included in here. So the way they're structured, the way the repayment of that community center bond is structured, our total debt service is not going to exceed $2.1 million for a levy because we have some bonds that we'll be canceling some debt on, we have some that we'll be levying on, and we have some existing funds in the community center bond as well too.
And then, Mayor, if I can ask.
Yes.
We've got two recon projects coming up, Shakopee Avenue East and Shakopee Avenue West. Both are pretty big projects. You're going to print money for them, right?
Yep.
Right? Or are we going to bond for that?
The questions are coming. The heat's rising.
It was getting warm in here. I'm sorry.
Are we going to bond for them projects, or are you going to just print money?
Well, we'll have to see when the project comes. But if it's an expansion project like that, there's that's usually bonding is usually done for those types of things. So, Okay. But those are usually a special assessment type of bond as well,
right,
too. So,
70% being a general levy hit.
So we should have, right. So we should have, you know, a combination of existing funds and bonding that would probably take care of something to that nature.
I guess I'm asking where the 70% is coming from to pay for the city's portion.
2017 CIP.
Two big back-to-back projects. That's a lot of money coming out of there.
Bruce?
Maybe I can help answer. I mean, we have not bonded for any of our street projects for years.
Right.
We were able to get like $1.5 million from state aid. We put a lot of that money into our account. We've been able to cash flow our. Mm-hmm. We assess 30% of the street, but most on a street recon, a lot of that cost is the sanitary sewer fund, the Buck Water Fund, the storm fund. So the 70% is probably 700,000. I think I'd have to look back in the, but we've been able to cash flow that through our capital improvement fund.
Budget in the CIP.
I think that's been the, we have not bonded for any.
Storm fund.
And we are putting money into the capital improvement fund still.
If you look on the
good. That's good news. Good news.
And you had a city that didn't have built up reserves like that, you would see bond issues every single year for their road improvement projects.
Yep.
Right. Sewer project.
Mm-hmm. And I misunderstood. I was thinking that you had mentioned something about future expansion or something to that nature where it was. But for a reconstruction type stuff, we've been able to do that in-house, as Bruce had mentioned on that.
That them are like two of the last big ones, maybe one more after that or so.
Yeah, we're getting down there where we might have recon, but right. We're ripping out pavement and replacing pavement, but utility work with the recon, that's going to
be smaller
roll
projects.
All right, Darren, continue.
So one other budget issue for this year was the creation of a self-insurance fund that we just created now within the last month or so. And the goal of the self-insurance fund is to take on the role of risk management. By establishing an appropriate fund balance, the city can cover the cost of claims to a certain point while realizing the benefit of reduced premiums. And so we went to our general liability and liability insurance policy renewal came due this fall. I believe it went into effect September 1st or August 1st. We looked at our deductibles pretty closely. We came from a city that had much higher deductibles and was a smaller city. And our current deductible was sitting at $2,500 per claim, which for a city our size is astronomically low. So we looked at our claim history as well. So we got to look at that. See, what is our average claim history? Turns out it's about $50,000 a year in claims. By increasing the deductible to $50,000, we can save about $150,000 on our premium. Well, you take that $150,000 savings, deduct the $50,000 in claims you normally have, and you realize about $100,000 on savings on average. Obviously, there's going to be highs and lows on that end of it as well, too. But that's for 2017. The nice thing about it is that when we renew our policy in 2016, we account for that expenditure all in this year. So when we renewed our policy in September, we increased our premiums, but yet our year was just about complete, and we'd only experienced, it was very minimal, $25,000 in claims. Now we got a few more this last week or so, but we should realize about $125,000 of savings in 2016. And so that'll be a nice amount of money to kind of kickstart this self-insurance fund to help us build those reserves. And in the next year, we can take part of those savings, realize part of those savings, but we can also realize part of those savings towards our self-insurance fund with the notion that we will eventually go to a self-insurance level, other than catastrophic type of coverage and such like that, but really get to an area where we can realize the benefit of premium savings and being in a self-insurance place, because we are a city at that size that we should be able to account for something of that nature.
At what number would we see a bigger savings? Where would our
it's all amount of risk if you want to take on as well too. So I think the premiums went from 10,000, 25,000, or the deductibles went from 10,000, 25,000, and 50,000. I think you can go up to 7,500, 150 type time frame, but I think we wanted to kind of ease into it this first year.
Just
got to get a fund balance to support us.
Yeah, and we will do that analysis, Counselor, and each year to try to figure out where that sweet spot is for us. But as Darren said, at this point we want to ease into that. Mm.
I was just curious.
We will definitely take a look at that next year and in each preceding year, because then as you get more years, you can dial it in a little better as well.
Yeah.
And you can use your savings.
Yeah, absolutely. That's correct.
Yep.
We can take the savings and buy a glass company for all these park windows.
Continue, Darren.
And I should note, we are working with Ms. Gabbard on the workers' comp renewal as well, too, and we're looking at doing the same type of a deal there in our savings on the workers' comp. I think our deductible right now is $500. We're looking at increasing that probably to $10,000 and probably realize $100,000 in savings very easily on that end of it. So that's in the works as well. And then lastly, I wanted to touch on the enterprise fund and specifically the sewer fund. We talked about this at our last council meeting where the council approved an 8% increase in the sewer rates. I just wanted to bring that to your guys' attention as well and to the public's attention as well, that that 8% increase in the flow rate and an additional 50 cent increase in the flat rate. I made that mistake last time. And this increase is intended to close that gap on that annual operational deficit that we have between our operational inflow dollars, the $2.24 that we charge per thousand, versus that, I believe it's about $2.60 that Met Council charges us for the Met Council operational piece of our costs. And then to mention that, as we mentioned last month as well, that we will be doing an in-depth analysis in 2017 to look at appropriate fund balances within both the sewer and stormwater fund and look at long-term forecasting, new development, et cetera, to really figure out where we need to be at for rates and how to get to that appropriate sweet spot. So in summary, this was my first go around at the budget. It was a learning process for me. It was a learning process for all the department directors and staff as well. And I want to thank them for their commitment to this budget process. They really realized the need for a critical balanced budget, or how critical it was for a balanced budget, in that they're aware of the bonding costs of the community center and ice arenas and that the operational costs were going to be there. And we needed to account for them, and departments really chipped in and looked out for the greater good of the city on that end of it. It wasn't their department that was the sole focus. It was the greater good of the city. So, and talked about that redesigned budget process a little bit of providing them that target. It was a pretty unique process, and it was kind of fun to see and sit down with department directors and go through some of those line items and say, hey, well, we just always, had money here and we never really used it. Well, I don't think we need this money anymore. And they were able to do away with it. And a lot of departments came in below their budget target amounts, in which, if you remember at our preliminary budget meeting back in September, we were passing a preliminary levy, but that's still, we weren't balanced at that point. We still had, it was a few hundred thousand. It was $400,000, I believe.
At that point, it was $450,000.
Yeah, to solve at that point in time. And this process really helped solve that. Obviously, the insurance part of it helped a little bit as well, too, but the department's really kicking in and finding out what their needs are and just budgeting for what their needs are and priorities are was critical. So I appreciate that. So here's just a quick summary of our general fund. Here again, it has that new column this year that you haven't seen in the past, a revised 2016 budget, and that will be, in essence, our final budget. You can see that, look at the licenses and permits on the revenue side of it, that fourth line from the top on that second to right column. Original budget was $1.5 million. We're budgeting now a revised number at about $2.2 million. So that's a substantial increase on that end of it. And so our revenues are coming in about $1 million more than what we expected. Our expenditures are coming in at about $1 million less than what we expected. In the future, I would expect those numbers to be very very close to one another. Our expenditures won't have those big fluctuations like that, and our revenues will be a little bit tighter as well too. We spent some time this year really going through with the departments of having them forecast what the budget revenues are going to be, rather than the finance director sitting in his office picking out what a number is going to be for a building permit, when the community development director, the planning director knows exactly what, or building official will know a better idea of what's happening out in the community. So that's what's happening on that end of it. So
this slide here with our December tax receipts in there.
This is not actuals. There's no actuals column right here. We'll get to that slide later tonight too.
All right. So.
And then here is a general fund expenditure report that is a little bit more similar to that annual or that monthly financial report that I provide as well, and breaks it down by each department, division, line item specifically. And you can see the budgeted expenditures on the far right bottom column, that $24.2 million, is the same that you would have would have seen on the previous chart over here on the total expenditure line. So with that, the next steps, this is a public hearing, and the public is welcome to speak on the budget and tax levy. I believe in the past, the council's probably approved the budget and tax levy on the same night, or you did last year anyway. I'm not sure how you'd done it, but here we're gonna, for this year anyway, we're gonna look at postponing that and approving it at our next council meeting, bringing forth an action there. So there is no action required tonight. This is just informational purposes and for the opportunity for the public to speak on the budget and levy. So with that, I'm open to any questions you have.
Well, before we're getting questions, I want to thank you, Darren, for, you know, we've been in these presentations here now for several months and they're very clear, calling out the issues, showing the resolutions point by point, and we do appreciate that very much. Thank you.
No, thank you. It's been a pleasure, and I look forward to
First, I guess I'd like to start out by saying thank you to Mr. Reynolds, the city administrator. He really took the initiative early on. He's new to the organization, did a good job of really taking ownership to this process. I really appreciate that. You did a very nice job. Then Darren came along and helped him out. Thanks for stopping by. Hope you stay for a while. And all of our department heads for you know, the job that they do too. There's always some things in budgets that one of us on council don't like. There's a few things that I don't like in this budget. The overall, considering where we were coming from, it's a pretty respectable budget, and I will support the budget, even though I don't like some items in the budget. The one area where I think a little transparency, well, it's in there, it's in the document, but where it would be easier to understand would be just exactly where, to the average citizen, what exactly has your local government done to you, and what position are you in? And I bring that up because we basically raised the sewer rate, we did raise the garbage fees, we raised the stormwater fees, we put a 3% energy tax on, and we raised the tax levy 7.5%. Pretty accurate? Am I pretty accurate so far?
Yes, sir. And I appreciate that. Is exactly when we talk about that 2-3 budget process, that is where we want to end up.
Well, all that information is in this budget through the slides that you showed. It's just not consolidated.
Correct.
And
it's hard to understand for people.
It is. The other piece that's missing completely is what is the wage inflation for the average in the private sector right now? Are we seeing wages going up? Are they stagnant? So we're looking at, okay, here's how much your government has cost you year to year to year, and here's what your wages have been doing. Are they going like this, or are your wages stagnant and your cost by your government's going up? Not just the city, but the county and the school and the federal and any other entity, I guess, because that's how most households operate. They look at, I'm not making any more money, but everything else is costing me more. Or they say, everything's costing me a little bit more, but I got a pretty good raise and I'm making more. So that piece of what the private sector is doing wage-wise shows a good balance. Other than that, I can't, considering, like I said, where we came from, we went into this community center and some of the other financial hurdles that we had. Mr. Reynolds, you did a great job grabbing it and taking ownership. Thank you very much. You did a nice job. Thank you, Darren. It's been a while since I could actually support a budget. Good job with all things considered.
Councilor Lewis, any comment?
Thank you to both of you also. I mean, it's been very transparent that I've seen, and I can understand it fully. It's very well spelled out. So,
no, I appreciate all the work. This is a change from the budgets we've seen in the past, and it was a challenge. I appreciate the work that everybody's done, and I guess we'll see if there's anybody in the public that wants to speak. So,
not a public hearing, but a resident like to come forward and comment on this budget or the process? There will be another meeting next on the 20th as well. Please come forward and state your name and address for the record, and welcome.
My wife, Kathy Greep, myself, Dale Greep.
Hi.
Hello.
Two different addresses I have here. One is 1350 Morris Street, Shakopee. Do you want the PIN number on either of these? You don't, okay.
Let's,
1300.
Excuse me for a second.
1300 is the other one.
Mayor, Council, this gentleman stopped down and talked to me today. I referred him to the county meeting, which was tonight, because a lot of his issues are on the valuation that was placed on the property. If we could get the overhead hooked up for him, are you going to share that information with us?
You could share it. I can give you my PIN number. You can put it on your own, or you can share it.
Do you mind if it's shared with the public?
That's fine.
Okay. Can somebody hit the overhead for him? Then that way, sir, the council can see what you're talking about, okay?
Thank you.
But truly, you're correct. If this is an evaluation question.
It is, but it.
It is to the county, but.
Yes. Okay, the PIN number is.
So you can set it. You can set it here, and then it'll show up on there.
Oh. Okay, first of all, this one here. You can pull it up in your overhead projector, can't you?
Yep.
Picture of the land.
You
have to move upward.
Yes, I can.
Just punch in the PIN number, you get the. Yeah.
So you're looking at the value?
They don't need the PIN.
Yeah, I'm looking at the value. Anyway, the GDP went up 2.9%. Your taxation went up 7.4%. My taxation on this piece of property went up 9.5%. Now you take the GDP and you triple it, I'm still above that. Now I'd have to raise the rent on my people, my renters. I'd have to raise them. And they're just hanging on by their fingernails right now.
So your property value went up? I can't quite make that out.
265 to 295, Mayor.
Okay.
Right, right.
You done any improvements on your property or?
No.
Planted a rose garden or?
No.
Typically
the new road that went in several years ago,
yep.
I paid for the new road, I paid for the curb and gutter, everything, so I owe nothing on this land. And when they do come by with sewer and water, which they're planning on,
yep.
It's going to be a bill that's going to hurt.
All
I've been there since 75.
Your property, and you're correct.
Correct.
Mr. Reynolds?
And I think it's important, and I'm sure Councilor Lehman had referred this this afternoon and why he asked him to go to the county. But for the public in general, you know, the city has no control over the valuation. That is a county process, and they are the ones that determine what the valuation of a property is.
I've talked to the county already also. Okay, let me show you this one here.
Should zoom it in a little bit more.
Yeah. Hard to see it.
Yeah, you should have a light turned off over there. This one went up 55%. Put that kind of taxes on your own homes now.
And it's just a piece of empty land with nothing on it.
No building, just grass.
No
services. That property doesn't have city sewer or city water either.
Correct, it doesn't have that. And they're talking about coming in. They've already talked to the neighbors with industrial land. That's what it is.
It's not a for sure, but it'll be in the future.
Sir, if you could slide that up, the people could see the percentage a little easier. The paper.
Slide it up a little bit.
There you go.
55%. Yeah, that's a pretty substantial increase.
We purchased this property in 1974. It's 2 acres, is that what it is?
Yeah, a little over two.
Two acres is just an empty
two and a half.
Piece of grass. And, of course, that was 42 years ago. Now we are on a fixed income in our mid-70s, and to get a 55% increase in valuation, there's no way on earth we could ever sell it for that. It's just not out there. And we even had it appraised in 2015. And the appraiser we thought was exorbitant, which we don't even think we could even sell it for his appraisal, we paid them big money for the appraisal, was 234. And now this appraisal is 298. So it's another 75 or 65 grand above what the appraisers, which was already high.
Darren?
Mr. Mayor, council members, residents should get, on the valuation notices, they should get valuation notices from the county in the springtime. So that's the time when you get your, actually it'll come out before your property, it probably comes with your property tax statement in the spring. But that's when your time to really contest that value or to ask the county assessor, you know, why is this property going from, you know, 200,000 to 290,000 specifically on that end of it. And
next time that's what we will do.
Right.
But we were out in Arizona, we winter in Arizona. And 4 years ago, the same property went up 44%.
Mm-hmm. So it wouldn't hurt to next spring, you know, even if it doesn't go up any, go and talk with the county assessor and find out, hey, can you look at this value and make sure that it's accurate? Because maybe it's overvalued for something as well too, so.
Like, we just had it appraised. We had it appraised.
Mm-hmm.
It's nowhere near this price. And you know, New York did the same thing. They kept raising the taxes, and they forced everybody out of there. So you know what they did now? I'm sure you all do. 10 years free taxes to come on back. That's right. You look it up. You hear it on news.
I'm familiar with what Detroit tried to do. So, Matt?
Well, I was going to point out that you already started the correct process where you went up and talked to the county assessor's office. And I believe you did that today, right?
Today.
Yep.
I've been there twice.
So to keep them on their toes so they don't forget between now and next April, I would write on your calendar that next April you're going back up there, even if nothing changes, because this needs to be looked at again. And the only people that can look at it is Scott County Assessor's Office. We have, even if we wanted to, we couldn't help you because it's not our jurisdiction. And how it works with the, you know, you've got the city tax, the county tax, the school district tax. Basically how that works is when we do our budget, like we saw tonight, 7.4% or whatever it is, that number and that multiplier is just placed onto that value to come up with the tax. So we don't even have the ability to lower it just on your property, even if we wanted to. But there's just no mechanism to do that.
Yet the city of Shakopee taxes on here went up a lot.
And the reason they went up is because the city's multiplier that was used on your old value was applied to your new value. It's kind of like 2% of 50 is one number, but 2% of 100 is twice as much.
So the only people I talked to is
fix that is Scott County Valuation Department assessment.
Assessor's
office.
Yep.
Yep.
I guess that's all I have to say then.
But well, it's good that you shared the information because there's
happening, yeah. Those are real numbers affecting real folks.
They're real numbers from Scott County.
55% increase in value, 50% increase in dollars.
If you read these lines here, it's about the meetings of the taxes. I believe that the root initial cause for your action or your gas here is the value. And if you've seen that, and when you get your notice in the spring, it says notice of evaluation, and if you have a problem with the value, here's a public hearing. It's not about taxes, it's about the value of your property. That was in the spring, and then county, cities use that value to set their tax rate for the next year. And our tax rate has moved up minuscule, but your value now, and that's where it all starts, and at the value, I would heed Councilmember Lehman's advice to get in front of that assessor again some more and make sure they have their speed dial set to your phone number and get there next spring.
If your value didn't change, the city's tax increase applied on your original value would have been a very small increase, percentage-wise.
Councilor?
Darren, on residential property, there's some kind of a circuit breaker that the state uses for a one-year reduction. Does that apply to vacant land?
That, Mr. Mayor, Councilmember Luce, that's a very good question. I wonder if that's homesteaded properties.
To get a property tax refund, you have to.
But it's something to check into, though. I mean, I don't take my word for it. There is a property tax rebate. There's a couple of them out there through the state of Minnesota that would be worth checking into just to see if they would qualify. But I'm kind of hedging my bet that it might be for homesteaded properties. But I know one of them is if it goes up over 10% or $100, you get a certain tax break on some of that. So definitely worth checking into. Great point.
Yeah. Well, I think I'm on the right track because I did get it appraised and I gave it to them today. I've seen them twice today already. So.
Yep. Definitely contact them in the spring, though, to make sure that action's been followed up on.
Thank you very much. And thank you for sharing your information with the public. Yep. Anybody else like to come forward and make comment in regard to the monthly budget or the budget meeting? Seeing none, thank you very much. Let's move forward then to 8C2, which is our monthly financial update. Darren.
Darren Joe.
Thought I was done.
You're very popular.
Oh, hang on 1 second. This is going to be short and sweet here, so.
Yeah, who's timing?
Keep him going. I'm surprised you went to sit down.
So it's Bill. Our, November financial update is ready for us. We're crazy that we're already in December. The years fly by and the months fly by, and it's crazy how fast time flies on this end of it. But obviously through 11 months of the year, we're about 92% of the year complete. Obviously, I've been talking to you about the revenues and expenditures not necessarily recurring equally or evenly throughout the year. And so we have these spikes in revenues and expenditures that we've talked about, with property taxes being a prime example of that, where we receive it twice a year. And so I don't need to go into that a whole lot more, but here's our revenues to date. Looking at our November year-to-date actuals, comparing those to budget, our total revenues are at about 70% or $17 million of budget. So obviously not at that 93% mark, but as the mayor asked me in our last presentation, have the December taxes been receipted yet? And they, on this report, they have not. This is through November 30th. We receipted our taxes on December 1st. And so that next day is on there. But I can assure you, we have since receipted those tax proceeds, and our revenues now have basically surpassed that 100% mark of our original budget at this point in time. So a couple things to point out: our licenses and permits obviously continue to outpace our original budget. That's why we got a revised budget in there in place. The only one that's kind of marginal or not below the original budget amount is the miscellaneous revenues, and that's at 87%. And I think I mentioned it last month that we are expecting our League of Minnesota Cities Insurance Trust dividend does come to us in December, and I believe we should be receiving a substantial dividend there this year as well.
What's up with the 500% fine and forfeitures?
When you have small numbers and you receive a big amount, it makes it throw out of proportion. So it's fines and forfeitures. So our budget was, you know, 1,500. We've received 7,500 to date, so we're 500% above it. Well, in reality, it's only $6,500, so it's not material-wise, dollar-wise material, but percentage-wise, it's.
Do you know if the money from seatbelt enforcement grant programs are included in that, or if that's going back into something else?
No, the grant money is not included.
Not the grant money, the ticket fine money.
Ticket fines now go directly to the county because they are used for our prosecution services, I believe.
So the answer is no, it's not in this number. Okay.
Councilmember Lehman, no, it's not in this number.
Did you get a ticket?
No.
That's what I was wondering. That's what I was wondering.
Okay.
I got the book.
Did Renee get a ticket?
I got the book.
Just wanted to see if you were trying to find where your money went. Yeah.
But no, I think it's the reason I brought it up, Mayor, since you want to talk more about it, was that if we're spending money to do click it or ticket type programs and turning around and making a 500% revenue stream on it, it looks like we're fleecing our own public.
No, and I...
Okay? Yep. And if I want to show that that's not the case.
That's fine. I get that. All right. Proceed.
Absolutely.
Or questions on this slide?
That was the revenue one? All good?
We're good. Thank you.
Looking at the expenditures, everything is at or below that 92 or 93% mark at this point in time. We're at total expenditures are at 84%. We should note that we will have a revised budget coming in for 2016, and that revised budget was about $1 million less than what our original budget was. So those numbers will tighten up then as we get closer into the end of the year. And in December, or in our January financial update, I'll be able to provide you with a December financial report that has their updated budget in it as well, so those numbers will get a little bit closer together. But we'll still be projecting to be under budget on the expenditure side of things. So that's what I had for the financial comparison. I was talking to Administrator Reynolds about a topic for tonight's meeting, and he mentioned the cost comparison. I had sent him some information a month or two ago on some cost comparisons, and we thought maybe this would be a good time to do that, looking at both the utilities and our tax comparisons and such, and that knowing that residents just received their truth and taxation notices in the mail and such, taxes are obviously on the forefront of their minds and are fresh at this point. So I have three slides tonight that I just want to quickly show you and kind of benchmarks the city of Shakopee anyway, comparison to some of the surrounding and comparable cities that we had come up with this past year as well. So this first one is our property tax comparison. This compares the 2016 property taxes for the median valued home in each respective city. So if a median valued home is different in each city, kind of think of it as picking up the same house, dropping it in each specific city. Based on that location, that value of that home increases or decreases.
So you're using the Shakopee's average.
Nope, I'm using each city's they've come up with. Met Council has some data out there as well, and each city usually has what their median valued home is. And so we've used each city's respective median valued home as the tool here to compare.
Would it be possible for you to put on this slide what their median valued home is?
Yes, I have that. I do have that at the end here where I can show that as well here too.
Surely we can beat our rival Chaska.
Speaking as a Chaska resident, when we get to the third slide, we'll see that Shakopee comes out ahead of them. So I should be at a different meeting tonight probably. As you can see here though, this is that, so we use that median valued home times their tax rate. So each city has their own tax rate, just as we have our, 37% tax rate. Each city has a respective tax rate. So you take that median valued home times their respective tax rate to come up with this property tax comparisons. It's not perfect, but it's something to compare that a lot of cities utilize to kind of at least benchmark or kind of see where everybody's at. And as you can see, you know, Shakopee's a good value on the tax side of it. It's, you know, in the top four there, and Blaine is a historically low one for some reason. We were adjacent to them from my previous position, and they were always in our study as well, and can't figure that one out, but that's where they're at. So on the utility costs, that's another big part of owning a home or renting a home in Shakopee is you have your utility costs. This chart compares sewer, storm, and water. And this is the same chart that appeared in the latest edition of the Hometown Messenger as well. Even though the city of Shakopee doesn't own the water utility, all these other cities own their own water utility. So I thought it's beneficial to compare apples to apples and so that you have all the utilities in one spot to compare. Because if you own both the water and sewer, you can do accounting shifts to make one or the other look better or worse than one. So by combining all three of those, we're able to see what that total cost is. And this is based off a consumption of about 60,000 gallons a year, or about 5,000 gallons a month, which is kind of that average household consumption. And as you can see, Shakopee again is in that number three on the list here. So we're very good on that side of it as well too. So
Like our storm is pretty much larger than most. As a piece of the pie, if I break down the colors.
Right, and it's, you know, the stormwater isn't a big portion of it, but it does appear that it's, you know, a little bit more than some others. And so I think when we do that utility rate analysis this spring, we're obviously looking at stormwater, so that'll be one of those to kind of peek at as well.
Does Golden Valley contract their water from the city of Minneapolis?
They do.
Yeah.
They do. And that's expensive water in the city of Minneapolis.
Right.
So that's a big cost for them. And that's why, well, their water is pretty substantially high there. But.
Councilor Lewis?
Blaine didn't record their stormwater.
Blaine does not have stormwater.
We don't either. It doesn't rain here.
They just have tornadoes. They don't have the rain. I don't know.
This infiltrates.
So that's you know, that's one unique factor about them. They're about one of the, there's only a couple in the metro that don't have a stormwater fee, and that's one of them. So not exactly sure how they manage things there, but that's a nuance between them.
Check with Darren.
So when we combine, this chart's a little harder to read, but when we combine the taxes and the utilities, Shakopee, if you kind of throw Blaine out of the mix, Shakopee's right there at that first tier of, you know, this is a good value. You're getting lots of services for a good bang for your buck on this end of it. So it's nice to be able to kind of see these. And if you compare them from chart to chart, you can see that maybe on the taxes, one was lower than another or one was higher than another. And on the utilities, vice versa was the case. But Shakopee ended up being on the lower end for both of those, which in the end puts it in a good place for a total cost comparison. So.
Sewer looks larger in this slide than most of them.
Might be the scale.
It could potentially be the scale of it. And if we want to look at the median values, I got that slide in the back here too, I think. So here's the median values. You can see in this third column here is the values. And I think they're not sorted according to value, but you can kind of look at the different cities and see where they lie. Golden Valley is the highest one, I believe, and then I think it was Coon Rapids, I think, was the low one at 165. So the range was 165 to 265 for that median valued home. And I should note that Shakopee in here is 210,000. In our last example with the budget meeting, we used that 229,000. That's the difference between Met Council's median valued home, which is what's used here, and then the assessor's kind of average valued home is 229,000, so it's a different average calculation or different calculation modes that get you two different numbers. So with that, that's about all I have for tonight. If you got any further questions.
I guess the only piece missing here is your total levy, because if you take like Prior Lake, the house values between Prior Lake, Shakopee, and Chaska, pretty close. But the rate, pretty big difference, and the actual tax, let's see, Shakopee, $37,800 bucks. Prior Lake is at a 32, because I rounded. Shakopee's at 38 for a rate, yet the taxes are within 40 bucks of each other. So obviously the levy amount and the total tax capacity is playing a role here.
Yeah, tax capacity, absolutely.
Right?
Yeah.
Right, because your tax capacity, your tax rate is built off your tax capacity.
Talk about value, and then, you know, it's the quality of the value, which is within the proof of the pudding in the tax capacity. But, all right, questions on this slide? You have shown three bar graphs and this slide, and, you know, trying to get apples to apples, and I know that's very difficult, but I think if we look at all these slides, Shakopee does pretty well. And I know there's probably some variance that we're not thinking about the values and all that, but it's cut up three or four different ways here, and it reads pretty good.
All right, thank you very much.
Got to beat our rivals, Chaska.
You beat them.
All right, more questions? Darren, thank you. All right. 8C3, 2016 City Council Work Plan. Mr. Reynolds, update.
Well, thank you, Mr. Mayor. As you all will recall, in early February, we sat down in a workshop setting to try to get beyond just our day-to-day activities that we clearly are going to do as an organization and get some direction from the council as a whole in regards to those short-term priorities that you had for us as an organization. And at the time, my thought process was to have that be part of a building block, much like the budget, where we've started to do some building blocks now that we're going to build upon coming up into the future years. Next couple years specifically, this next time that we move forward with this type of a process early next year, we're going to not only talk about in the next year, but more importantly, from a city council perspective, we're going to start talking about some strategic thoughts and processes and where you want us to be in 5 and 10 years down the road. So you can expect that in the future. But this was a very good exercise for staff because if you'll recall, since I've been here, we have replaced one-third of your City Hall staff. Now, I want that to sink in a little bit. We have lost a lot of that knowledge base and a lot of that day-to-day activity and a lot of that interaction with council in regards to knowing what council knows just kind of because of having all that experience. So. You know, at that point, we didn't have a full-time finance director. Our assistant city administrator had just announced that she was leaving. We didn't have a full-time director of planning and development. And we had we had some other major key pieces in the middle management that were also missing. So all that being said, you know, as I put this particular update together and in talking with staff, the amount of pride that I have in this organization, I cannot really really describe to you, because this organization and these people, whether they were brand new to the organization or where they had been here, how many years you've been around?
two.
Or whether they've been around here 22 years or longer, came together and worked on these goals that you had set out. I have a lot of great respect and admiration because, you know, from my perspective, I asked them to do a lot of things that they may not have been comfortable with because they didn't understand exactly where we were headed. But they were willing to allow me the opportunity to try to show them as we move forward. And that was especially the deal in regards to the budget process. So as we look at this really quick, and I won't go through everything, but I do want to make some general comments in regards to the work plan and also some of those areas that, frankly, we just didn't get to or didn't do as well as I might have hoped. But in starting out with the finance piece, Darren and his staff, in conjunction with the department heads, just did an outstanding job. And I gave them some general direction. And then I got out of their way. And they were able to put into place those key elements that you had requested for this 2016 year. If you'll notice there, I've got completed for 2016, because reality is, I think that these are probably some of those strategic goals that we're going to talk about coming up early next year, that they're really not just one-year goals, but they're long-term goals. So yes, we did complete all of those in the finance for 2016, and then obviously the great work that Darren did with the franchise fees and moving that forward, which was approved on September 13th. In land planning, if you'll recall, we did a lot of work in land planning before Mr. Kursky was here even, and specifically when we were talking about our R4 discussions, which was great because now staff has a real good feeling as to where this council stands in regards to R4 development, but also with our West End plan, which was also done before we had a full-time director on board. We're currently The comprehensive plan is due in December 31st of 2018, so that is obviously something that we will continue to work on into the future. And we also have done some ongoing work with our infrastructure needs. One particular area that Councilor Lehman and I have been talking about quite a bit is in regards to traffic, transportation, and transit, and he may have some comments on that a little later as well. That's obviously an ongoing piece. I spent a portion of my Monday morning at the 169 Coalition meeting down in St. Peter, and was interested in getting a little more spun up now that I have an assistant administrator on board that allows me kind of look the opportunity to outwardly focus. And then we talked about that at my meeting here with staff on Monday afternoon then. Talked specifically about R4 already. The riverfront, you know, I've specifically tasked Nate with his background at the county level. He has a lot of experience with watershed and water issues, and he is spearheading that particular effort, and you can expect that to be ongoing as well. Specifically in economic development, we had quite a bit of progress for completion. SAC reform and economic development incentive reform were both completed. It took us a while to get there on SAC reform. It took a couple times for us to dial in on specifically what council wanted, but now I feel very comfortable with it. We have that dialed in, and it's good to go. Currently working on the downtown issue, which we have major project progress on. I just received today, and I'll get it out tomorrow, the latest drawings on where we are with the downtown, and I'll get that out to you tomorrow morning. We're continuing to work on the old City Hall project as well and trying to find a use for this particular building. And then our final was just an amalgamation of major projects that we had on the horizon. Community Center, operational management, we've got that worked out. New City Hall construction continues. We have had our challenges there, whether it be steel or weather related. But at this point, the construction manager believes that we can make up some of that time frame from here forward once we get the building buttoned up. South Bridge fire response, we have the final product in regards to the study. Both Bill Rudnicki and I would like to have both of our organizations, both councils, sit down in a joint meeting, which would be interesting, I think, and then kind of work through that in a workshop setting so we have an idea as to what both our organizations, whether it's yes or no, what your concerns are, we can kind of work that out together. Succession planning is moving forward. That is a long-term piece. Frankly, I didn't get as much done in that area as I had originally intended to or had hoped, but actually was working on that piece today a little bit. We've had major progress and clear direction and in communication between departments, so we will continue to move forward on those issues as well. Revitalization, stabilization of staff. As I said, we've replaced one-third of City Hall personnel at this point. I'm extremely comfortable and proud of the team we currently have in place and am excited about where we're headed in the future. Customer service. We're getting there, but we're going to be a heck of a lot better when it comes down to it. There are a couple big initiatives we have. Obviously, the physical construction of City Hall itself and the way it's designed, once that's put in place, that will have major positive effect both on our internal and external customer service. But we also are, and this frankly is in great, because of the great work of Mr. Kursky when he first got on board, is putting together that single point of contact. So if Bill Reynolds needs a fence permit or doesn't even know that he needs a permit, but he knows that he wants to build a fence and he wants to do what's right. So he's going to come to City Hall. He's going to talk to the person at the front desk, and she's going to say, well, I got exactly who you're going to talk to, and this one person is going to handle that issue. And so they'll only have to deal with one person, and so they won't have to go talk to engineering. They won't have to go talk to over here. They won't have to pay over here. We're going to take care of all that in the background. We will, as City Hall staff, because it shouldn't be incumbent upon the citizen to try to figure that all out, and because even when they're trying to do the right thing. We're going to take that. Mr. Kursky has been leading that effort and pretty excited about where that's headed. Also, in regards to that customer service piece, we're going to have, we're moving fully to electronic plans. So we can actually have the customer look up where their plan is in the process. Right now, if somebody calls up to the front desk and, you know, I dropped my plans off last week, I'm kind of curious as to where they are in the process. Well, let's track them down.
We're as curious as they are.
Yeah, you know, and that's the reality of where we are. But under this process, they'll be able to log in, take a look exactly where their plans are in the process, and also where it's being held up. So if they're sitting on Bill Reynolds' desk, you know, maybe John Smith is going to give Bill Reynolds a call and say, Mr. Reynolds, I'd appreciate it if you could move my plans along. That's something that they do not have the ability to do now. I'm really excited about where we're headed in the customer a service. That is one thing that is very near and dear to my heart, and where my focus in the future will continue to be. The other piece that is very dear to my heart, as I think you all know at this point, is transparency. And as I've stated, especially during the budget process, we can put information out there, but if people can't understand what it is we're putting out, we're not being transparent. We have to put it in a way that they can actually understand it and use it in their daily life. Inclusive and diverse workforce, real excited about some of the things we've been able to do there. Out of the last 10 full-time hires, 5 were women and 2 were minority, which is not always an easy thing to do, simply because it's very difficult to find minorities that want to work in government that are qualified. You know, there are a lot of other options out there that they could probably make a lot more money on. Policy review, this is probably another one of those areas that I wanted to do a little more with. But I think that we'll see more of that in the future. The concept was is that once a month we dust off a policy and we'll bring it forward or an ordinance. Nate has been working very hard and combing through our ordinances for the last 2 months, three weeks. How you've been able to stay awake is beyond me. But we've got a list of ordinances that we do have concerns with that we want to bring forward to you and kind of get your idea in regards to how we handle those in the future. So not as much.
We had some pictures in those. Codes and ordinances.
For yeah, no pictures. Right. No pictures. Code enforcement, we have a new code enforcement policy that was adopted on 5 April, and we have our new CSO hired as well. Digitation, I talked about in a few minutes ago. And finally, signage, trail wayfinding. Another one of those areas I frankly didn't get as far along as I had hoped. I guess I could say that, you know, I was kind of waiting for the downtown project to get a little solidified, but that's probably just an excuse. You know, we definitely need to hit that hard next year. So, I'd be more than happy to ask any questions, or if you'd like to have some more information come back to you next week or in the upcoming couple months in regards to this, any of these issues, then please let me know, and we'll certainly have the subject matter experts, which is not me in any of it, but bring the subject matter experts in to talk to you in depth about it.
Comments? Questions? I'd like to actually say thank you, too. Now, it's almost been a year. I think we did this in February, developed our work plan, which had, I think, 7 different areas and some bullet points under each category. This is a pretty impressive list of where we're at on those things. Some things were achieved. Obviously, we're talking about the financing and all that. I'd like to do another workshop and pick up right where we left off and maybe even delve into, you know, one of those categories in specific. I don't know if, and try to figure out and try to do the priorities and look at that and kind of continue forward to refine it and do it more strategically. That's what I would like to see from that aspect. Matt?
The comment that I would have, not necessarily on your point, but on the overall presentation by Mr. Reynolds, is the third of staff turnover, as difficult as it is for the organization, was equally difficult for some of us on council.
Yep.
That were here throughout that.
Yep.
And it's nice to see a little bit of stability back into the organization. It's not something that, you know, I haven't seen anything like that happen in the years that I've been here to that extent. So I'm glad the bench has got some people on it, and now we're back to where we've got some stability.
Yeah, and there are a lot of times that we're simply not going to know, and we're going to need time to be able to figure out things, and you know, whether it's HR or even in my position, and then you know, heaven forbid if Bruce ever leaves,
he ain't leaving.
you know, that would be a significant loss to the organization, as we all know. So,
cuff him right to the chair. Chief, cuff them down, will you?
No, I think we've made a lot of progress on many of these points with the short staff and are now full staff. But in some areas, I would have liked to see more progress and maybe different results. But you know, that's going to happen. And but like the mayor said, we can bring these back and talk about them and flush them out a little more at another time. So. Yeah.
And the continuity and stability of staff was high on our list, and I think the quality of people that have been hired under your watch, Darren, Nate, Jennifer, Michael, the others, fresh eyes, sharp eyes. I think I've already seen that that's helped our community, helped our city, and will continue in the future. Thank you. Other comments?
I'd just say I'm just getting to know a few of these people. It's a little overwhelming trying to get used to all the different faces, but we're working on it.
I wouldn't say any of them are of low quality, but it's pretty early to judge whether, you know, where you would place them personally, but personally doesn't really matter. It's, you know, either
they're trying to get to
either
know
they're
us.
Competent or they're not.
They're
know,
trying to get to know us.
I'm sure they are.
In the same vein.
And we just haven't had the opportunity to work with them long enough yet to have that relationship. So it comes with time.
If that's it on that item, thank you. Moving ahead to liaison reports, and I can't remember where I started last month, but or last meeting, but we'll start down here. Councilor Lewis.
I did not have any liaisons. I do have one tomorrow with MBTA. I did attend the tree lighting last Friday. Very good turnout. The weather was a little crisper than I would have liked, but and no snow, but very nice turnout. So that's all I have.
Thank you. Councilor Lehman?
Attended the inner working group with the Prior Lake and Mittawakaton Sioux community today. One of the things that they talked about that I'm going to give the staff to print out and hand out to the rest of you folks was the Arctic Lake Restoration and Trail Connection Partnership Project, which is 81 and 82, just south of Mystic Lake. There's a big 23-acre lake, I think it was, back there that carp-infested and very high phosphorus. So they through the organization, they managed to partner with Scott County, Prior Lake. I think Three Rivers came on later on, the Mittawakaton and stuff, and they're cleaning up this lake, which has an outlet from Prior Lake that drains into this lake. They're doing some unique things out there with iron things that capture some of that phosphorus that they can take the iron things out and remove some of it, but then they've got some soil issues that they're correcting and a pretty extensive trail issue program around it that's going to be open to everybody. It's a good example of how multiple jurisdictions working together for the greater good of, you know, water quality and you know, trails that can be used in natural areas and access issues. I think it's just a good example. You know, a lot of people probably don't realize how important it is to work with some of our neighbors, whether it's the other jurisdictionals or sovereign nations in this case. It's got a breakdown of, it's a pretty intensive report. I think it's like 10 pages or something. So that was a pretty interesting conversation. The other thing that we talked about was some transportation issues that I brought up that I'm going to bring up with council at the other business portion, and I'll wait until that time to bring that up. But if I could get that to staff and have staff go ahead and just share that with the rest of the council.
Yeah, I'll. You can hold on to this. I'll go ahead and scan my copy and send it out to everybody tomorrow morning.
All right.
That's all I have. And then we're meeting with the township tomorrow, so.
Okay. I don't have a lot. I met with a faith-based group a week ago. I also attended the festival downtown on Friday night. Two weeks ago, went to a Met Council governance meeting that was a group that was set up last year, and will continue to do that. Yesterday, met with staff on the orderly annexation. Obviously, a meeting tomorrow. But that's all I have to report.
Okay, thanks. I made the tree lighting event. I thought it was well organized. A lot of different stations and things. I'm glad to see that the Main Street program is jumping in and taking over that stuff and making things better. Last night's public utilities meeting, they went through their annual adjustment of fees for their water connections and trunk charges and reconstruction fees, and actually had one fee go down on the undergrounding of the utilities. That fund had enough money to support itself, so that was nice. But that was the only one that went down. Otherwise, there was two outages, one that affected one service on Hilldale Drive, another one on the 22nd, where I think it was an ice storm of some kind that had a tree contact, and there was multiple customers out for about 55 minutes, but it was in the middle of the night, so it didn't have great effect on a lot of people. But that's about all I have to report on.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Bill Reynolds, administrator report.
Well, Mr. Mayor, my report is essentially the sum up of the year, if you will. So not much here.
Thank you. Item number 10, other business. If there's no other business, we'll entertain a motion to adjourn. Councilor Lewis?
Yeah, I just want to reiterate to the public, the Fund for All Playground is totally funded. We do have some funding to do with the donor wall, which if you want in on it, you want your name on it, better hurry up, because I think I've got enough in the pipeline to cover it. So, let's see here.
What else can we get him to fundraise on?
I got a few ideas.
Thanks a lot. That's it for now.
Councilor, thank you very much.
Yeah, nice job on the park, Mike.
Very nice. Councilor Lehman?
The one issue that I wanted to bring up, the new president-elect is talking about a $1 trillion, potential $1 trillion infrastructure stimulus, if you want to call it that. I'm not really sure what they're calling it. But to me, it would almost make sense for, you know, Shakopee and our surrounding communities in the Southwest Metro Quadrant to think long and hard about, you know, we probably don't have much time, but start thinking about what road projects, bridges, because it sounds like it's going to be roads, bridges, and that type of brick and mortar stuff, best serves our area. And when I say our area, I say the Southwest Metro area, not Shakopee specifically, mm-hmm. because I think it's going to be important from the federal perspective that, you know, if they can put some money into an area, where does it help the largest population in a large mm-hmm. area? And I think it would really make sense and potentially give us a higher percentage of success to have more people on the same page. You know, if you came up with a project that said, you know, here's five ideas that, you know, scale backs, is that have as much weight as five ideas that two pages of supporters from multiple areas support? So I think the more collaborative effort toward it would give you a better possibility of receiving something. So I would ask, you know, that maybe our staff start taking a look at working with some of the counter staff, you know, Scott County and the cities around us and Mittawakaton and everybody else to start taking a look at what type of projects do we have on a shelf that haven't been done in the past, that could be done, that benefit the Southwest Metro area.
Has this been brought up in the 169 coalition group?
It will be on January 8th, and it kind of was touched on at the last meeting when the chair asked if I would join their executive board.
Mr. Reynolds?
And just real quick, one of the projects that Councilor Lehman had mentioned to me that seemed to be of value for that regional effort, it wouldn't be based in Shakopee, but clearly would have some value added, is another bridge off of 41, for example, which ultimately at some point you would think would need to be brought forward. And I think the key is that now we have this opportunity, as Councilor Lehman has pointed out. Let's kind of get our ducks in a row and see if, you know, as he had said earlier today, if we fail, okay, it doesn't cost us anything. So
right. Exactly.
You've got to try to fail, though. Yep. I mean, yep. That's part of it. I know that 169 was, 30 plus years in the making, and I know the other location was still there. It's been kind of revised and then kind of not, and, you know, major Southwest transportation project. So,
Mayor, there's been a lot of work that's gone into the future 41 River Crossing. The last numbers I saw on that project was $830 some million. I mean, it's a super highway. The plan that I saw was pretty substantial all the way up to the 312.
Right.
And if you look at the map of the metropolitan area where you have the 694-94 loop and then you've got the outer loop of 494, that would complete the outer loop of 169 mm-hmm. coming down and being able to go back around. So it would create that outer loop.
And
you know, years down the road, you're going to have like a 282 Jordan massive river crossing and have a fourth loop. And right. You know, when we talk about growth, we talk about urbanizing as we expand. Mm-hmm. Well, from the federal highway system, if we look anywhere in the country, it works the same. It expands in loops to them areas, and so we're not asking for something that's outside the box. We're asking them to follow
getting
their own model.
Getting prepared for the future.
Absolutely. Well, actually, we're behind. If you look at the standpoint of river crossing capacity, we're behind, way behind. So it's something that we need to be thinking about, because if that administration comes out with something like that and we don't have something in there, you know, you can't receive something that you haven't applied for. And you know, I feel pretty comfortable we'll get nothing, but I feel really bad if we don't try.
I think that'd be a good opportunity for some of these programs like the 169 Coalition.
Absolutely.
Along with SCALE that has those multiple jurisdictions involved.
Yep.
To try and work on that. And we have a good opportunity next year with Mayor Mars as chair of SCALE to be part of that and maybe organize some of those groups that might put some of those ideas together. I'll believe the funding when I see it.
Right.
But
right.
But the ideas are a good thing to have in hand.
Yeah, and I don't disagree with you at all, Jay. I mean, I'm just thinking, you know, if they're talking about it, we have some needs down here in this area, not us specifically, but this region, and we need to be proactive to put on a table what our needs are.
I'd rather make sure we don't have any more bridges falling down in the entire state.
Well, absolutely, absolutely, but. We've definitely got some needs in this quadrant of the state and country, and you know.
Councilor Lewis, did you have?
Yeah, you know, if we get enough into this, you know, we can be a little more shovel ready than the last administration. That'd take my job.
All right. Other business? If not, I want to wish we have a meeting coming up on December 20th. Which will be our old Tax and Truth Nation meeting. But want to wish everybody a happy holiday.
I might not be here. I might be on big Christmas vacation.
What did you say, Mr. Councilor Grinch? What?
Yes, that's me.
It's
the time of the season when I have to play Grinch. I mean, Santa Claus. I mean, Grinch. No, that's right. Grinch is right. You're right.
Do you want to make a motion to adjourn, if it's okay?
I'll make a motion to adjourn to Tuesday, December 20th.
Second.
All right, I have a motion.
Seconded already.
Oh, I apologize.
Want to give you my
motion on the table. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, motion carries. Thank you. We're adjourned at 9:50.
No, thanks, everyone.